Howard 101. In a country where the obese outnumber the skinny, who is looking out for the little guy? Who is willing to sit down and say, I'm not too big, this doorway is too small? When you need someone to say, we're fat, we're here, and we're going to get extra mayo on that. The Fat Guy Show. He's large, he's in charge, and he's full of advice. Your fat host, Jason Kaplan.
Good evening, everybody. I am your host, Jason Kaplan, and yes, I am still fat. Welcome back to the second episode of the Fat Guy Show, the day after the Super Bowl. Real quick, introduce my guest, the author of The Fattest Guy in the Room, Mike Sangiamo. Mike's a big Giant fan. Nice to have you here.
I'm a big everything.
You are a big everything.
That's right.
First of all, how was your Super Bowl last night?
You know, it takes years off your life when you watch close ones like that. You gotta believe in Eli, though. So much of the food that was piled in before the game, I restricted my eating to small bits during the game, but of course big courses pregame and halftime and postgame. And I ate something, I don't know what it was, I think it was a cookie that turned my shit completely green. Oof. This morning.
All right.
So it was like fluorescent green, it was scary, but I made it here. And I'm excited to be here, and I'm excited the New York Football Giants!
All in, baby!
Super Bowl champions!
But listen, this is the Fat Guy Show, and as happy as I am about the Giants' victory, we do have to move on, so call in 888-STERN-101. That's 888-783-7610. If you're a fat guy and you have tips, advice, stories to share, call in. If you're a skinny person who wants to know about the inner workings of a fat person or has a good fat story to share, call in. Mike, the Super Bowl, as you alluded to, is one of the all-time great fat guy holidays because it centers around food, and it's one of the few times a year I feel totally comfortable just eating in front of everyone. I don't feel everyone's attention's on the game and on their other crap, and everyone has a 90-foot sub in their room. So it's one of those holidays as a fat guy, I feel like, hey, I'm hanging out with everybody else. I'm doing what everybody else is doing. Yeah. Is that your experience?
Yeah, well, you know, there are days where I feel like I can eat whatever it is I want to eat, and I call those weekdays and weekends.
Yep.
Actually, I enjoy the Super Bowl more when it comes to food when the Giants aren't in it.
Right.
But and that's why you could really let loose and go crazy. There's no apprehension. But, you know, I think I did a pretty bang-up job yesterday of piling in some calories to counteract the apprehension.
It's so great. You know, Super Bowl, Thanksgiving, they're both really good fat guy holidays. And with the Super Bowl that you don't get during Thanksgiving, which I love more than anything, are dips. If I could dip it, to me, it's more about the dip than the actual food.
Yeah. Two different styles of food. Two completely you got that home style feel for Thanksgiving.
Right.
Which I particularly love. You know,
I love
the gravy and the mashed potatoes. But this is more, it's finger foods. It's picking. It's picking throughout the day. And you could really get a much better variety of food than you can during any other holiday.
That's absolutely.
Why I love the Super Bowl.
And it's more like a trough setting or a sizzler setting where you just get up throughout the 4 hours.
Right.
Exactly. You get up, you get some, you get up again. People don't notice how often you're getting up and going to get the food. It's great. So I love dips. Real quick to run down my menu last night, because it was just me and my wife. I wake up early. But I started out with some homemade spinach and artichoke dip, which might sound healthy, but really that's mostly mayonnaise and sour cream and four different kinds of cheeses. I had some the scoopable Tostitos. Thank God they the scoopable ones.
Yeah, they got to have it. Yeah, now, whether the big scoopable ones or the ones with the little ridges in them?
The one with the little ridges.
Okay, I like those. It's like a little party.
I got a little, if you've never tried this stuff, you got to get it. It's J&D's Bacon Ranch Dip. It's a powder. Mm. And you put it in mayonnaise or sour cream or both, and it makes, I had that with the Ruffles.
Can we end the show now and just go get it?
I know, I'm fatting out over here. I made myself my own roast beef sloppy joe, so three layers of bread, some fresh roast beef, some horseradish, and mayo and ketchup. And I know you have a little bit of claim to fame. You invented the Feast Subway sandwich.
That's correct. So we had a staple of every Super Bowl ever since 2005 when the Feast came on the menu has been the 6-foot. See, this is something a lot of people don't realize, that Subway does have catering, and this isn't going to be a Subway commercial show, but I will tell you, you know, you get that hard Italian bread from the deli, which the Subway 6-foot party hero is the exact opposite. It's got that braided soft bread.
Oh, good.
So it's much easier to eat a lot more because your jaw doesn't get tired from chewing. You don't get the top of your mouth ripped out from the hard Italian crust. I love a good hard Italian roll just like everybody else. But when it comes to a party sub hero, I can't. And if you get the feast as a party sub, which basically is their two Italian-American sandwich. You got the BMT and the club together.
Right.
Pepperoni, salami, ham, turkey, roast beef, all together. I'd say mix it up with provolone and American cheese. You get that on a big six-foot party sub. It's out of this world, man. I could down 3 feet of that on my own. And that was really where you started for my Super Bowl food preparation yesterday. But I also added, because you got to get, I think what was always missing from my Super Bowl parties,
right,
McDonald's.
Ooh.
I had to get it in there somehow. Because, listen, if you're a fat guy
and
you love fast food,
You
got to somehow work McDonald's in. I wanted to stay away from the burgers just because we did have our big sub as our primary meat of the evening. So what I went with was a bunch of 20-piece chicken McNuggets and just French fries. So McNuggets and French fries. And if you haven't tried this yourself, you got to do it. As an appetizer, this is going to be at my wedding. As the appetizer, it's going to be chicken McNuggets with little toothpicks in them and just fries that you could just take, just McDonald's French fries.
Did you get the dipping sauce? I don't want to turn into a fast food show.
All the dipping sauces
came
with it.
Beautiful.
I go very standard with, I like to dip my McNuggets in barbecue sauce.
Okay.
And then really what I do to practice is I lick the barbecue sauce off the chicken McNugget. I could go through an entire pack of barbecue sauce. It takes a lot of skill to do this.
I hear you.
A lot of one pack of barbecue sauce for every McNugget. And that really, it's about the flavor. That's the flavor.
That is a lot of flavor.
It's a lot of flavor.
I will say that there is nothing more exciting than getting fast food in a setting that you didn't expect it. I was at a friend's party a couple years ago, and it was just standard party food.
Yeah,
everyone was drunk, and somebody walked in with a White Castle Crave case. And they were a rock star. I mean, they were just a rock star. That's awesome. Mike, give us some of your stats real quick. What's your height? What's your weight?
I am 5'6".
Yes.
345 pounds.
Ooh, 15 pounds heavier than in your book, the fattest guy in the room.
That's right. I was a prophecy. I gained weight since the book came out. I think that just I spent so much time sitting down, reading it and rereading it and trying to book famous gigs like this, like the Fat Guy Show.
And I have a suggestion for your book, and I hope you don't take this the wrong way, but I didn't expect this. When you came in, you were even fatter than I thought.
Okay.
And I think the thing is that you're, it doesn't come across in the book how short you are. You're 5'6".
I'm 5'6".
I don't know. And I read 5'6" and I hear 5'6", but it wasn't until seeing you. But I have something to tell you. You are fat.
Yes.
And I am fat, and you are welcome here on this show.
Thank you.
We got to do the fat guy thing where we're trying out different chairs before the show started.
Oh,
so you find one. And I felt so bad because we found one that we thought was good for you, and you're like, oh, I hope I fit into this.
Yeah.
I've been there. I'm there all the time.
Well, I sat in the first one with no armrest. And believe me, I have an entire manifesto on why armrests should never be included on chairs anywhere.
Right.
Because what's the fucking point?
Right.
I mean, if you're going to build a chair, why not build a chair that everybody could sit in? Not 75% of the world could sit in, right? But I tried the chair with no arms. I must have hit a lever because the chair shot through the ceiling. I almost knocked over the studio. We almost didn't even have a fat show. But I found a show. I've squeezed in. I'm also only going to leave a little mark on my ass, but that's okay. Listen, I'm a trooper. And I'll do it for the show.
You can see a picture of Mike and myself on @SternShow on Twitter, and we both retweeted it. You're @FeastManMike.
@FeastManMike, and I'm going to retweet it during the break.
And, of course, Mike's website is
BreakTheScale.com.
I just lost track. Oh, but anyway, I just wanted to let you know that not only are you not the fattest guy at Sirius, you're not even the fattest guy at Sirius right this second.
There's another fattest guy in the room?
There are two guys here at Sirius. Hey, Matt. You don't say anyone's name, but help me out here. Just a really immensely fat guy that wears a beret and has a goatee. I think he works at the NBA channel.
Yes.
Would you say he's bigger than my guest right now?
Yes.
By a lot, right?
Yes, by a lot.
And then there's another guy named Lord Sear.
Yes.
Who works on Shade 45.
Yes, he does.
If anyone's seen Willy Wonka, he looks like Violet if she never got shrunken back down. He's like a big blueberry with a tiny little itty bitty head. And so I just like you to know you're in good company. And my point of this show is, you write that you are a fat guy in a skinny guy's world.
Yes.
And I am here to tell you, my friend, the skinny guys are losing. 60% of America is overweight or obese.
Yeah.
It is skinny guys living in the fat guy world.
We're taking over.
We are taking over pound at a time.
But I just don't think that corporate America is following suit. I mean, I think they're taking small steps, but I'm talking about the things that, I took the bus here and the train here.
Right.
Let me just tell you something. I sat on the single chair on the bus, and I haven't taken the bus in many, many years. I'm telling you, I am almost more off the seat than on the seat. And it's not comfortable. Not comfortable. So, that part of it sucks. They almost have to move to the two-seater just to,
be in a normal seat, right?
In a normal seat.
We're going to get to more of that in a second, but I want to go to some calls. Hey, Fred in Brooklyn, what's your height? What's your weight?
Hey, how's it going? I'm 6'1", and I'm 295 pounds.
Nice.
Right, yeah, that's good.
What's going on?
I just wanted to say, a couple of things. One is, I don't know if I invented this or not, but I love chips and dip, and I can't get enough of them. So what I did is I took a whole, I guess it's a pound of sour cream with the Lipton's onion packet.
Hold on, Fred, I'm going to interrupt you. The Lipton's French onion is dip. Have you ever had this?
Yes.
You take the whole packet, you put it into a whole thing of fat sour cream. Don't get that non-fat or low-fat stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, it is so good. Okay, go on, Fred.
Oh, all right. Then I took some chips and I crushed them up, just made a big fat chip and onion dip situation. And, man, I'll tell you, I ate it with a spoon. I couldn't get it down quick enough.
So you had the dip and then you chopped up your chips into the dip and then you ate the whole thing like a bowl of cereal.
It's brilliant.
Fred, if I had a prize to give you, I would. That's a beautiful call.
Well, thanks very much. I hope you guys, the other thing, I don't know, kind of off track, but I love chocolate chip cookies. So when I go to the market, there's a market not far from where I live, they offer free cookies. At least they used to anyway. So what I used to do is I'd go shopping, I'd make like I was going to get some pastries, and I'd reach in there and I'd grab a handful of cookies and walk around the store. And one day I ended up cleaning out the whole bowl. The next week I went back in, trying to pull the same slick move, and they ended up having the cookies behind the case.
Behind the cage. And that's what it all comes down to. They treat us fat guys like animals at the end of the day.
Sometimes it comes down to it, especially if you're that hungry. What I think you should try, just, and I love that idea of his creation is fantastic. Something I think is very underrated. Crushed up Ritz crackers.
Okay.
I think you could put crushed up Ritz crackers in almost anything and it'll make it taste so much better.
So you're just talking about like you're eating anything, you take a couple Ritz, you crumble it up.
You gotta crumble them up because there's something about the consistency or the flavor that's brought out when they're crushed up. And if you roll something like, if you roll like a cold cut in a crushed Ritz cracker, something that's moist, like in a nice turkey breast or a roast beef, put that on your sandwich, it adds so much more. I'd eat anything that was rolled in crushed Ritz cracker. I'd eat squirrel.
It was rolled
in crushed Ritz crackers.
Listen to me. Is someone taking notes? Because I need to be able to follow these instructions after the show tonight. I hope everyone at home is writing this down. Steve in New Jersey, you have a comment about Sloppy Joe's.
Yes, I'm a skinny guy, so I'm 135. So I can't say much of it.
Hey, skinny guy, pick me up off speaker and come on.
Yeah, sorry about that.
There you go. Okay, so tell me with the Sloppy Joe.
Yeah, I just had this conversation with a couple people yesterday, one about Sloppy Joe's and one about Taylor Ham. And you mentioned Sloppy Joe's before, which I don't know if people across the country are listening, but if you could explain to them the difference between a Sloppy Joe that's in New Jersey versus a Sloppy Joe that everybody else in America is.
That's an excellent point. I'll tell you what, you hang on the phone with me while I do that. A Sloppy Joe, I think to most of America, is beef, a hot beef with
tomato
sauce on a big Kaiser roll or something like that. Or
hamburger
big
bun.
Right. In Jersey, a Sloppy Joe is completely different. It's a cold sandwich. It's usually roast beef or turkey or roast beef and turkey with something called slaw dressing, which is my favorite thing in the world. And I made it last night. It's mayonnaise, ketchup, mustard, a little bit of horseradish. You mix it all up. You get that nice pink consistency. You throw a thing of coleslaw in there. You mix that up, and then you throw it out in your sandwich. Steve, am I explaining everything correctly?
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't know if you mentioned it, but I'm going to miss it. The triple decker.
You get
them right. They're in a triple decker. And that's a weird thing. Is there a family tradition for me on Christmas Eve? Don't ask me why. And Taylor pork roll is another thing that's native to New Jersey.
That's right.
And that's a big contractor special here. If you live in New Jersey, Taylor ham, egg and cheese, salt, pepper, ketchup.
Anywhere in New Jersey will serve you that, and anywhere outside of New Jersey will claim to have absolutely no idea what you're talking about.
Now, what's the point of why? What is the origin of this difference in Sloppy Joe?
I have no idea.
What is it in Jersey? What is it about Jersey? Got everything backwards? Or
yeah, we've got to do our own thing. I don't know, but it's delicious. To get back to football for 1 second, because I love football as a fat guy. Football gives fat people hope. There's no fat basketball players. There's a few fat baseball players, but not really. And there's no fat hockey players. But football is a fat man. I am the most unathletic, uninspiring, everything. Just throw un in front of it.
You inspire me, Jason.
Thank you.
You inspire me.
But even I played high school football. Like, even I could get it together to stand and let some asshole run into me. Because that's what fat guys are good at.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so when I watch football, and sure, you got your Tom Brady's and your Gronkowski's with their abs, but most of the guys on the football field look like me and you with shoulder pads.
You still got
on.
Your Jay Alford. You know, you still got those guys. And that's, I think what I really love about football is that it's got that once a week thing where you can, if you're smart, you could turn your Super Bowl, you know, eating extravaganza into an every Sunday thing. I know that's what we do. I got hosted by my friend Nick and Paige Capace, and she is the greatest cook that's out there, and she makes an unbelievable spread every time we watch the Giants. And that's all you need.
And it's football. And we're going to talk about, coming up later in the show, we're going to talk a little bit about what it's like to be a fat guy eating in public, even with your friends and family.
Yeah.
But again, the Super Bowl, Thanksgiving, basically any summer holiday, you know, Memorial Day or July 4th with barbecues, it's like a fat holiday because people aren't staring you down. Everybody's eating like a pig. Nobody is looking at what you're doing. And to me, that it's just one of the, it's freedom. It's freedom. Yeah.
I love it. What's interesting is, I got a call in my book, in the back section. I have this part called Fries at the Bottom of the Bag, where I go into different stories. And one of the stories I tell is the famous Ron Dixon story that used to play for the Giants, number 86. And basically, long story short, I fainted during his kick run back. And then 10 years later, I became friends with him because I told him that I fainted. And he called me before the game. He lives down in Florida. And do you know that geographically, the Super Bowl eats is different? Because he was getting ready for the Super Bowl, but it was all barbecue based.
Down south. Okay.
So they can get a barbecue going, you know, the weather's nice enough. So think about, like, because I've never had that for a Super Bowl party. I mean, Super Bowl party was always the big sub. We got
pizzas made.
Hurricane Grill and Wings out in Levittown set us up with a huge display of wings, all the different sauces and everything. But that's what it was, wings, big subs, chips, and dips. Down south, this guy's talking about hamburgers and hot dogs like it's 4th of July. It's crazy.
We're going to take one more call before the break, and then we're going to come back with a whole bunch of fat tips and advice, and we're going to learn a lot more about Big Mike. But first, somebody who shares your love of Ritz crackers, Will in New Jersey. You're on the Fat Guy Show. Give me your height. Give me your weight.
Will.
Hey, guys. Hey, Jason. It's William. I'm sort of a skinny guy. I'm 5'8", about 155 pounds.
There's no shame in that, my friend.
It's okay. Nobody's perfect.
Yeah.
I eat like a fat guy. Here's the deal. Jason, first of all, you're not fat. You're big boned.
Okay, thank you. I'll take
Husky.
That.
Husky.
Here's the deal with the Ritz crackers, brother. It's take the Ritz crackers, put it in a small cup. The small cup, of course, the real sour cream, not that old bullshit light stuff.
Right.
Mix it up with a bunch of hot sauce. It is fucking heaven.
Nice. All right. Well, again, I know I have somebody writing this all down for me because I have a whole bunch of new food I'm going to check out later tonight.
Where it's at.
Listen. Before we go to break, go check out Mike Sangiamo at BreakTheScale.com. You can find out about his radio show and his book, The Fattest Guy in the Room, which I highly recommend. You can follow him on Feastman Mike on Twitter.
Feastman Mike, that's
right. And we'll be back with The Fat Guy Show. Call in 888-STERN-101 only on Howard 101.
We'll be right back. Call 888-STERN-101, The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan on Howard 101. We're back with The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan on Howard 101. Call 888-STERN-101. Now, here's Jason Kaplan.
Hey, now, welcome back to The Fat Guy Show. I am your fat host, Jason Kaplan, and I'm sorry if I didn't give out my height and weight at the start of the show. I am 5'10", 10.5-ish, and I'm up to 280, or down to 280, depending on how you're going to look at it. Clearly overweight and into the obese territory. And during the break, we had another fat guy moment with Big Mike Sangiamo, who you can find on BreakTheScale.com. Mike is my guest tonight. He's author of The Fattest Guy in the Room, and he was wearing a sweatshirt at the start of the show, and he said, oh, it's too tight on me, it's too restricting, something I can totally understand, and he asked if he could take it off, and I said yes, and now he is shirtless in the studio.
Right. I don't like topless, because that makes me sound like a girl, but you gotta get past it. If you got the man boobs, you gotta get past that, and who cares?
And real quick, we'll get back to the man boobs, but, you know, as a fat guy, one of my fat guy rules for dressing is always dress in layers. Yeah, because I feel that the undershirt smoothed out the fat roll. So I was expecting when you took off your sweatshirt to have a shirt underneath it. Little did I know. And what is it with fat? I noticed you're almost as hairy as I am.
Very hairy.
I don't know if that's a fat guy trait, like hair equals fat, or you get so fat the hair starts growing, it doesn't know where to grow on your body. So
I got my mom's features and my daddy's fixtures, and I think my hair comes from probably my great grandpa out there in Irish land, and you know, so. But it's really good when the hair on me back you could braid. I think that's when you had something to be proud of.
So Mike, you came to me by way of the book you sent me, The Fattest Guy in the Room, and it looks like a self published book.
Mm-hmm.
I put it aside, I'm not going to lie, and kind of ignored it for a couple of weeks, and then I read it on the subway, and it blew me away. I love it. It is everything I think about a fat person. I don't agree with everything you write in there, but I certainly understand it and appreciate it.
Yeah.
And so why don't you give us a little background? How did you come to write this book? How did you grow up fat?
All right. It's a pretty simple story. I'm just a fat guy from Queens.
Right.
Grew up with my parents and my Italian grandparents in the same house. And, you know, they were old school generation, so they had the 4:30, 5 o'clock dinner, which usually led to the 9 p.m. or 10 p.m. snack.
Right.
My dad, he hates my guts because I said he was the fattest guy I knew, basically in the first page of the book.
He did.
But you see, what I was trying to get at was, as a child, he represented fat to me. And, like, my grandmother represented old, even though she was fat, but she was
so
old.
So as long as you weren't as fat as your dad,
I wasn't the fattest guy in the room.
Exactly.
Till I went to school.
Right.
And then, even though I wasn't really that fat in grammar school and high school growing up, I was made to believe by all those motherfuckers that were in my class, and now look at me now, Howard 101, bitch.
Yeah.
you know, all these people that made me feel like a piece of shit because I was the fattest kid in class. And, you know, that carried all the way through. That carried all the way through high school, college, and really it affects everything in your life. When you're identified as a fat kid,
right,
and you turn into a fat, unless you know, my brother was just as heavy as I was growing up, and then he got into every sport he could find, and he's still a, you know, big guy, but he's a fireman and he's in shape. I went the other way.
One of the things you wrote in your book that I think you maybe regret is that you, once you realized you were the fat guy, you played into that role, and you're like, okay, I'm gonna be the funny fat guy. I'll be the guy that,
yeah,
right. And
well, it
that
led me,
pigeonholed,
yeah,
you, right?
Yeah, oh yeah. When I was about 15, 16 in high school, I realized pretty much overnight, and actually I know that, you know, Dice is always a big part of things that go on here, yeah, Andrew Dice Clay. I heard an Andrew Dice Clay, record, and, you know, this was years after Dice had come out, so he wasn't popular, but I mimicked everything he was doing, and I went to school with it, and I realized I could be funny. Basically, through impersonation, I realized I could be funny, and then I used wit to hone my humor. And when I realized I could be funny and fat, I had this whole new identity of the funny fat guy. So back then, I thought I could be like the next Chris Farley, you know, or Zach Galifianakis, you know, for those of you who don't remember Chris. So I played into it, and I was all in to being the fat, funny fat guy. Every meal became an extravaganza. I was the guy that ate the big steak.
Right, your friends would say, hey, Michael, eat this.
Yeah,
or, hey, put
he'll
this
eat
down.
Anything.
Yeah,
exactly,
right.
Yeah. High school lunch was always extremely over the top. And then we just continued to go forward with that. And, you know, my friends, I was surrounded by people that were also big, but then there was also a contingent of the people that were the skinny people. And I don't like these people, the skinny people that act like they're fat guys, like that say that they eat all the time, and you know that they don't. And,
right.
You know, and they almost want to double, you know, get both sides of it. They want to act like they're fat, but be skinny.
Now, I had,
own it.
I wasn't huge growing up, like through middle school and high school. My dad's a very big guy. Mm. And I started putting on weight in college. That's when my weight started accruing. And I remember it was my sophomore year of college, and I heard someone talking about the new fat kid they hired. And it took me a while to realize they were talking about me. Okay. And that's the first time I realized, oh, shit, I'm fat.
See, I think that's probably a little different from most people. Probably knew it when they, I'm talking since, third, fourth grade.
Right. I was going to say, so, because I know you wrote in your book that you realized you were fat in third grade.
That was another fat kid.
There was another fat kid.
There was another fat kid in class, and his name was Michael. So some reason, that's what really made me, I was like, oh, that guy's fat. And then I'm like, oh, I'm fat too. And then I remember the next year he left the class, and that's when I kind of realized, like, I am now the fattest kid in this class. And that's how I judge myself, whether it's in rooms or in classes. Or whatever, I always felt like I was the fattest person there. And I was treated that way. You know, everybody treats you just a little bit differently. And listen, this is about insecurities, and that's what life is about.
Right.
So I had a lot of, I was very guarded about it. You know, even though you can't hide being fat, I always talk about, the guys that wear the t-shirt in the pool. That was me.
Right.
That was me until my mid-20s. I'd wear the t-shirt at the pool. Because in my warped mind, I was like, no one's going to know.
Right.
No one's going to fucking realize. I have man boobs, but I'll wear this shirt in the water because that won't look strange at all. And I remember, the one rare occasion where I had to wear no shirt on the beach, and I felt so self-conscious about it. And it really wasn't until, it wasn't until I got laid that I really was like, fuck it. I'm just going to walk around with no shirt on. And I kind of missed some of those things about being self-conscious about it, but at some point, you just got to be happy with yourself. And the title says it all. 10 Reasons Why Being Fat Sucks.
Now, this isn't a diet advice book. This isn't everyone should lose weight.
No.
You're like, listen, this is how I got to 340 or wherever you are today.
My highest was 379. That was my highest.
And actually, the reason that was your highest, you have a story about that. You were researching, you were having trouble wiping yourself, correct? And at 379, and
at
you 379, started researching.
And I went, so 379, you see, what happens is you get to 379, you don't realize it.
Right.
You all of a sudden, especially in mid-20s, you're at 379, you're like, I'll never get that.
Fat guys don't weigh themselves a lot.
Oh, no, never. Exactly. There's no fucking scales. I have to go down to, I know it's funny, but my scale's at the car wash.
Oh.
And it's a digital scale that goes up to 400 pounds. It's probably not accurate. When I say go down to the car wash, people think that I'm weighing myself on a fucking truck scale.
There is nothing worse, and I'm sure you've been through this, when you cross the 300-pound threshold, when you go to your doctor's office for your check-in, and their scale only goes up to 250 or 300 exactly, and they have to bring in another scale.
Yeah, yeah. And my doctor didn't even have another scale. So at that point, he was like, listen, you got to get down into the weight range where you could be weighed on a normal human scale. But at that point, but really what it was the 4X shirt. When I got the 4X shirt.
Right. That was a big wake up call.
That was a big wake up call. I was like, cause something about 3X was okay.
Right.
I think cause I was wearing 3X for so long. 3X was okay. That was normal. But when I got the first 4X shirt, and it looked like a tablecloth. It was fucked up. And I really was like, okay, I can't be in the 4X thing. And then also, as you get older and you get less flexible, this is the reality, the situation. This is why I wrote the book. Being fat does suck. Now, listen, that doesn't mean I want them to be exploited. I hate fucking shows that exploit fat people.
Right.
Fuck that.
Like Biggest Loser.
I hate that show. I can go on for 10 years about that because we're not sideshow freaks. We're not animals. We're human beings. More people are fat than skinny.
That's my point.
Exactly. But that doesn't mean I just hope that maybe one day the reason you want to know the reason to buy that book, the reason to read that book.
Yes.
Inspiration. Because if you are a teenager that's heading down the path I was, you'll be inspired to change. Because the bottom line is, you and I both know, the health argument just doesn't fucking work.
No.
It just doesn't work anymore.
Right.
And that doesn't stop people from smoking, it doesn't stop people from drinking and driving, and it doesn't stop people from being fat. But this is some real shit. You're not gonna get laid as much.
You won't
be able to shave your balls before a date because you can't fucking see your balls. You can't reach your balls. And wiping your ass, that's a whole nother get to the point where you can't really wipe your ass anymore. And then you're going to realize, like, holy shit, I have to lose weight.
And that's, but that's what it was for you. That was that your highest, right? 380?
379. It really wasn't the wiping the ass thing that really got me. It was, it was the shirt. And then I realized, but it was all at the same time. Cause then my flexibility, I think I mentally tricked myself out. I couldn't reach. So I'm going around and finding different ways. And then I, just for the hell of it, I looked up assistance tools for people who can't, but this, they were for handicapped people, Jay.
Right.
They were for handicapped people, not fat people. They were for handicapped people. So it looked like a double-bended stick that you put the, I don't even know how it would really work. But when I reached that point, I said, fuck this, I gotta lose some weight. And I did, and you know, I bounced around, but I'm still an active guy. But now I'm getting older, I'm 32. There's a part in the book where I talk about anxiety, panic attacks, and all that
mortality,
stuff.
Mortality.
Oh yeah, you start, because once you hit 30, listen, for you people out there that are 27 years old, once you hit 30 and you're fat, it all changes when you're 30 because your mind starts thinking that that twinge in your chest, that's a heart attack. Or that pain in your arm, it's a heart attack. You know, and you think that way because you get mentally tricked out. So the book is really about sending a message. It's not just for fat people. It's not just for skinny people. It's not a wagging your finger at people, lose fucking weight. It's supposed to be real advice, a supplement argument to the old health shit that doesn't prevent anybody from being fat. And also, it's to bridge the gap between you skinny motherfuckers that don't know what it's like to live as a fat person.
That's what I was going to say. I mean, yes, you do write 10 reasons that being fat sucks and 3 that it doesn't suck so much.
Yeah, exactly. And those are jokes,
and
really.
And listen, everything you write in here is true. But I think it's more for a skinny person because it really brings you into the mind of a fat person and the anxieties and the feelings. And yes, listen, I'm sure there's a bunch of you out there saying, hey, you're fat. Fuck them. It's your fault. Fat and whatever. And that's
it's
fine.
It's your fault. Especially, you know where those people line up? At the fucking airport to get on the plane. And then they sit next to you and then they blame you.
Right. Exactly. You know, so some of the things you bring up, which I share, obviously, and I'm sure all fat people do, one of the things that sucks about being fat is seating, whether it's at an airplane or a restaurant or
fucking kitchen table, the diner,
or booths, a radio show.
Right. Booths. I hate booths. Why do they fucking bolt these booths to the ground? Are they afraid someone's going to pick up the booth and run out the fucking door with it? I don't get it. Well, they should just make every chair with no armrests and be able to slide in and out.
Well, I don't think that skinny people understand.
They don't understand.
The
they don't
scan,
know.
The RoboCop type scan that fat people do when they walk into a restaurant.
Oh yeah.
We're on a hold. We're not even paying attention. Like, there's an empty table over there. Or that booth looks like it could be pushed out or something like that.
See, the worst part of it is that you have to get to the point where you don't care, because if you care, you got to do that scan and you got to be the only one who knows you're doing the scan.
Right.
But like I said, I reached a point. Another thing I wanted to say, I wrote shit down that I didn't want to forget to say. I'm only here because of the support of my friends, and that's not a fat joke.
Right.
Support friends, you know, people could think that's a fat joke. My brother, James Sanjamo, told me about the fat guy. He's the one who got me to send you the book.
Great.
So I really appreciate him in my life. All of my friends have been pushing me towards something like this. And like I said, brother, this ain't the end. It's the beginning. But if you open up about it, you don't have to do that RoboCop scan.
Right.
Because I just tell them now, listen, I'm going to the diner. I want a table, not a booth. And I hate those fucking bar height shits.
Oh, forget it.
Because I'm short too. So your ass falls asleep. Your legs fall asleep. The whole thing sucks.
Now, we've talked about, on my last episode of the Fat Guy Show, we did talk about airplanes. And, I know, listen, fat guys get a lot of grief because, you know, those seats are tiny, and you sometimes spill over. You can't put the armrest down, or you need a seatbelt extension. I know you wrote in the book that you haven't been able to put down your the tray.
Oh, the tray table.
In years.
Never. Okay. I remember when I was a little kid. You know, God bless my mother. Right. She took us to Disney World every year from 2 to 12. So I remember the days when putting my tray table down, and I remember when I lost some weight, being able to put the tray table down was like, holy shit, look what I can do. But now I just try to get a seat where there's nobody sitting next to me so I can put their tray table down.
Yeah, well, that is the key. And there's some great fat guy tips about getting, trying to get the exit row or the emergency row because they're bigger and they usually don't sit people next to you. But my point, and I think it's your point about the airplane seating too, is that it's not our fault.
It's not. It's not.
Every airline has different size seats. There are some airlines, Continental, I sit in their seats. It's like everybody else. I don't know. It just works. Delta, I'm squeezing into the seats.
Yeah.
And my point is that I buy a ticket, You buy a ticket. Mm-hmm. We all spend the same money on tickets. There's no guarantee that I'm not going to be sitting next to someone gross or creepy pervy or as you put in your book, smelly.
Exactly.
Or,
it's a, right. You know, and then why did you point at me and look at me and say smelly with my shirt off?
Well, you are sitting right across from me here.
I apologize for that. But see, to me, it's about comfort.
Right.
It's all about comfort. Now, listen, I have the ability to control who I sit next to the same way you do. So if you want to control who you sit next to, buy two tickets.
Right.
Buy the seat next to you, and then you don't have to sit there. I got news for you. Listen, I love you, and I love all the people out there in radio land listening, but most people I fucking hate. And if I had the money, I'd buy the row in front of me, the row behind me, and the whole row I'm sitting in, because I don't want to sit next to anybody. So if you want that comfort, fucking buy your own ticket. Or here, buy fucking first class.
Or skinny people, and this is my big thing, blame the airlines. Don't blame the fat guy.
Exactly.
I don't get a letter in the mail from American Airlines going, oh, up to 230 pounds, and then you're spilling over. They don't tell you. I have to put my bag, my carry-on luggage into a thing that tells me if it fits on the plane or not, but I don't have to put my own stomach through
that. Exactly. It's discrimination.
But if the airline told me ahead of time, hey, dude, you're 285, you know, we feel it's going to take up two seats, so buy two seats. Okay, at least I know going in.
Yeah, you don't want to get to the point where they just fucking kick you off the plane. It's funny you say
it's
that.
It's not the fat guy's fault.
It's because there was a guy, an airplane executive, which most of these people are greedy, rich motherfuckers, or they're skinny people, or they're being told by fat people what skinny people, they were being told by fat people what they want to hear that the fat people are thinking. And this guy actually said, it's not about the size in the seat, it's the weight that's causing the fuel costs to go up. Now that's a line of horseshit, because I'm sorry, if your fuel costs go up because your passengers are too big, then you got to absorb that as the airline. It's not our fault. Don't fucking keep on adding. It already costs too much
just
to fly.
You know what, airlines?
Go fuck
just,
yourself.
Just stop selling the fat guys, okay? We'll find our own way to go. Hey, Pete in Pittsburgh, I haven't taken a call in a while. Give me your height, give me your weight, buddy.
Yeah, 5'9", 155 pounds.
Braggart.
Athletic.
Yeah.
What's wrong with skinny people calling?
Huh? They're,
hey, listen, we love you too.
Jason,
what's up,
Pete? I was just curious, you know, you've discussed your drug issues with marijuana, and you have anxiety issues, you've taken pills over the years, and now, you know, you're telling everybody how fat you are. Do you think that's the reason that you're the number three producer and Will is actually number two in line?
Well, I will say it's possible, but again, Will has cancer or had cancer and, of course, is weak and can go at any minute. So I think we're both health-wise probably at the same life expectancy. No, I don't think that has anything to do with our job. I'm very open and honest about how I look and what I do and how I get through life. And I think that's only helped my job. I think the honesty has only helped my job. Otherwise, I don't think I would still be here. Ben in Seattle, give me your height, give me your weight. Ben in Seattle.
5'9", 170. I'm a thin guy, but I've always wanted to be fat. I know your guest doesn't think that's true, but listen, I fell in love with the woman who caters and is in the food business. I moved in. I put on 9 pounds in the last 3 weeks, and I've never been happier.
Okay, well, that, you know, that's food. Food makes you happy, man. It's a big part of getting fat.
Exactly.
So let's get to eating in public, because as long as we're talking about restaurants, this is something I am obsessed with. And I know you can spin it as, oh, you don't care anymore or whatever. Yeah. But whenever a fat guy goes out to eat, it is a no-win situation.
It's no-win. Yeah, it's no-win.
If you eat healthy, if you go out and you're not that hungry and you get like a salad or some sushi, everyone's like, oh, the fuck, oh, everyone's, you know, you're good for you.
Yeah.
Or don't do this
don't
just for us.
Lie. Yeah.
Right. They never
get
believe
what you
it.
Want.
And then if you eat like a pig, now
that's
you're,
how you got that way.
Right.
Who are you?
Oh, it's so disgusting. It's an embarrassment.
Why are you alive?
Do you feel even now, I know you say you're more comfortable in your own skin and accepting, but do you feel the eyes on you when you're eating?
Without a doubt. I you feel the eyes on you when you walk down the street. You feel the eyes on you, especially when you're in an eating place. And that's another thing I really don't like a lot of about a lot of places that will offer you extra stuff on the menu.
Right.
But make you say it.
Right.
I don't want to say it. And you know, a lot of times these people are losing sales because I don't want to say it.
You don't want to say out loud, like, I want the extra mayo, I want the extra cheese on the side.
Well, extra mayo and extra cheese, I'll say that, but like, you know, the extra meat is a really good one. A lot of the sandwich places offer extra meat at an extra cost. I would rather just have a very big sandwich.
Right.
To purchase, and that's the one I want. That's what I want. It just comes with that meat. I didn't put that meat on it, but when you get a double meated turkey sandwich, oh, double meat. Double look at meal. You, yeah, fucking fat ass. You know,
like, already,
is there anything else you want?
Yeah.
Bacon? Extra bacon?
Oh, you could just hear it. You know, other fat people, because I do it's other fat people, too. I'm not saying other fat people. You fat bastard, you don't need that.
Exactly.
And here's another one with Valentine. We talked about the great Super Bowl and how great that is, but one of the worst fat guy holidays is coming up in Valentine's Day. First of all, it's not always easy for a fat guy to have a date on Valentine's, but
it's
then
not
also
easy for a fat guy to have a date anytime.
Right. But then also, what do you do? How do you eat in front of the girls? John from Long Island, you give us your height, give us your weight. You were on the Fat Guy Show.
I'm 5'11", 215.
Jesus Christ, a skinny audience out there. And
we have some fat people calling the show or what?
So I got a question for you.
Sure.
I know you're married. Presumably you've dated your wife before you got married. So how do you deal with going out on a first date with a woman?
Again, this goes into the...
first date stories.
For me, it goes into... It's a lot of anxiety because you want to split the difference between not eating like a pig in front of her, but not getting a salad like a chick. And so usually on a first date, it's been a while since I've been on a first date, but...
me too.
It's anxiety about what you're going to order. And then also you have to think about how you're going to eat it. Like, you're not going to get a bowl of spaghetti. You don't want to get anything that's going to, you know, fat guys take bites out of sandwiches and stuff, you know, stuff ends up on your beard and then So for me, it's depends on where we are, but it is a source of anxiety. How about you?
It's interesting you say that, because I think with the advent, and believe me, like I said, I got a million hours of material on dating alone and being a fat person dating. But with the advent of online dating, a lot of those anxieties can be swept under the rug because you've kind of talked about, listen, if you're fat and you're on and you're trying to go out with somebody, you're going to talk about being fat, because I don't know what everybody else subscribes to, but I hate those people that if you're on online dating, because that's the primary way everybody fucking meets anybody these days, you don't put the picture of just your face on there and then just expect that somebody's going to like you for your personality, because that's just not the real world.
Right.
So I lay it all out there. I'm fat. And listen, if you don't like fat people, then I'm in search of what every fat guy is in search of. I'm looking for the tall, skinny girl that loves fat guys. They're not out there. If they are, they're probably somewhere in the Midwest, and they're probably some very religious people, so they don't get blowjobs, and that's very disappointing to fat guys, because everybody, you know, fat guys love blowjobs. Anyway, so when it comes to eating on the first date, and all I know is dating fat girls. Every girl I've ever dated has been fat. They've all been fat. So I don't even care about what I eat. I'm watching what they eat. And if they get a salad, bullshit. I call them out on it, because don't eat like a, you know, who are you teasing? Who are you kidding? It's not what you want. Get what you want to eat. And God forbid, talk to me about how you exercise. Because you don't. You don't, okay? It's just fucked up. The whole dating thing is fucked up.
Let's go to one last caller before our break. Johnny in Florida.
Fiddlestick.
Give us your height. Give us your weight.
6 foot and about 230. I don't get on the scale anymore.
Yeah, you're a fat guy. Go for it. What's what do you got going on?
I used to be 285 before I got married, and I lost a lot of weight.
Good for you.
Hey.
Well, you know, I had to. I got a kid now, and then my back is shot, and my knees. So I had to do something. Plus, I didn't want to have a heart attack, you know, when my kid was 20 and never seen me again.
Good. Good
is
for you.
Me calling? It sounds like me calling.
Well, here's the thing. I've flown when I'm about 285, and I've flown flying about now. And I don't get on the scale because that's the worst thing you can do. I think I'm about 230 or so. And the truth is, I have to say, first of all, I have to side kind of with the airlines at this point, that if you're too big to fit a seat like Kevin Smith, you got to pay for the extra seat. I'm sorry. It's your own fault, usually. You can say thyroid or glandular, but you know, we all know that 99 times out of 100, we eat too much fucking bad food.
Yeah, but my point is to the
customer's always right. What happened to that?
To the Kevin.
No, the customer's not always right. We all know that.
To the Kevin Smith scenario, and everyone could have a different opinion on this. Again, Kevin Smith doesn't know he's taking up two seats until he sits down on the plane. Now, the plane is perfectly aware of what the size of their seats are. I don't know if it's legal them or not to ask for our weight. But my point is, why should we get on the plane and then find out you have to pay for an extra seat?
You're assuming Kevin Smith is honest and never been on a plane before. I mean, we've all been flying since we were kids. We know that gradually the seats have gotten smaller and smaller. I don't know if you guys have ever Googled the future of airline seats, but the new seats that they're proposing are pretty much standing. You're almost standing. Later.
Well, Johnny, but here, you bring up an excellent point, and I don't know if where you're getting your facts from, but seats are getting smaller and smaller, but every study shows that Americans are getting bigger and bigger. So what are the airlines trying to do?
Trying to make more, get more of your money. That's what you're trying
to do. They're trying to maximize their passenger usage in the hull of the plane versus the fuel costs, because they know that, you know, if they can pack more sardines in the can, that they can actually save some money along with.
Oh, sorry, Johnny. I cut you off. The problem is we're not sardines. The problem is we're big, fat, fucking blue whales, and we fly. We're people. We're not sardines. And listen, America's getting fatter. In fact, when we come back, I got some fat news about the fattening of America. But right now, you're listening to The Fat Guy Show, only on Howard 101.
There's more to come. Call 888-STERN-101, The Fat Guy Show, with Jason Kaplan on Howard 101.
Watch out, fat boy!
Oh my God, he's huge!
He makes sumo wrestlers look healthy.
We're back with The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan on Howard 101. Call 888-STERN-101. Now, here's Jason Kaplan.
And welcome back to The Fat Guy Show. I am your fat host, Jason Kaplan, with my fat guest, Big Mike Sangiamo.
That's me.
You can check out more about Big Mike at BreakTheScale.com, and to order his book, the one we've been talking about all night, The Fattest Guy in the Room, is available on Amazon and Barnes & Noble. But of course, if you just go to BreakTheScale.com, that's all the information on how to get the book there. And you are going on a book tour.
I am going on a book tour, which is the second book tour we did. We did one down in Florida. We hit a bunch of spots in the Orlando area back in December. We were out of town when the Giants played the Redskins. Thank
Good
God
for you.
I didn't have to see that.
Yeah.
But the book tour is coming up. My publisher definitely, because it is self-published, but I didn't publish it. It was actually a media company based in Orlando, Florida, called Vineland Media.
Okay.
They picked it up, and they actually fronted it. You know,
so where are you going? Where are you going?
So the book tour is happening. We're going to Midwest, because we figure there's probably a load of fat people out there.
Fat guy heaven.
So it's starting on February 16th, and it's all college-based. We got one book warehouse on Saturday. But Thursday, February 16th, if you're out there in Chicago, we're going to be 11 a.m. at the University of Chicago Bookstore.
Chicago's a great fat town. I've been there.
Giordano's Pizza. I love it.
People are huge out there.
It's going to be great.
It's wonderful.
The fat people. 11 a.m. University of Chicago Bookstore. 6 p.m. DePaul University. Then Friday, we move over to University of Indiana in Terre Haute, Indiana. That's at 11 a.m. Saturday, we're at the Book Warehouse in Tuscola, Illinois, 11 a.m. Sunday, we're going to find places to eat and probably, you know, some strip clubs.
Sure.
Monday, February 20th, we're at IUPUI, which is the Indiana University, Purdue University, Indianapolis campus, 11 a.m. And then the final date, Tuesday, February 21st, Beloit College in Wisconsin. And while we're in Indianapolis, you know, we're going to go visit Lucas Oil Stadium.
Beautiful.
And pay homage.
Home of the victory. Hey, now this is your first trip out to the Midwest, right?
One of my other claims to fame is I've been to, I travel all the time. I'm a road warrior, love road trips. Been to 48 states. And actually, after the book tour, because of everything that's been happening in my life and the book sales, I'm taking a trip to Hawaii to knock off number 49.
Good right for you, my man. So, and speaking of being excited on the road, CWB in Tennessee, welcome to the Fat Guy Show. What's your height? What's your weight?
Yes. Glad you finally picked up on me. Fuck yeah. My fellow fat brothers in arms.
How fat are you?
5'10", 5'40".
Whoa! Hey now! What is your question, sir?
You was complaining it's a light show. By God, it's now heavy.
I like it.
But anyway, man, and first off, before my question, motherfuck Pete in Pittsburgh. Yeah. Damn, athletic, 155. Fuck you, dude. Go fuck yourself.
All right, what's your question, bro?
But, yeah. All right, man. You just mentioned traveling, like you said. Where's the best places that you found to get grub on the road? Because I probably got a few myself.
Oh, man. Giordano's in Chicago. That's the best stuffed pizza you're going to find.
There's a billion places.
Piggy Shack down in, Memphis, Tennessee. Got some barbecue out there. Oh man, we could be on the show forever.
Throw on the Food Network, watch some of those, food travel shows. Honestly, for me, the road, that is what McDonald's and Wendy's and Burger King, that's what God put them here for.
for fat guys
traveling. So that's great. So make sure to check out Big Mike Sangiamo on his book tour in the Midwest, I've been to Wisconsin, I've been to Chicago, there are fat people out there. They make us look like pikers.
It's going to be great.
I love it. So go to BreakTheScale.com for all that information. And now, some fat news. We have, hey, Matt, I know I didn't tell you this, but do we have a news, like a little news?
Yes,
music?
Give me
Thank
one
you.
Sec. I'll find
hold on. I'll talk that up slower. And now, a little fat news. Nope, too fast. Well, fat news. Thank you. That's my fault. I didn't tell Matt ahead of time to get that music ready.
Jay, one of the things I wanted to accomplish.
There we go.
Oh, there we go. One of the things I definitely want to accomplish is get the word out, because you never know who's listening.
Right.
I am in the Screen Actors Guild, and I've actually done a lot of voiceovers for commercials. And if I could, may I use my instrument for this? And now, Fat News with Jason Kaplan.
Beautiful. From CNN.com, an obesity epidemic has hit U.S. pets. That's right. Nice. According to CNN.com, 53% of adult dogs and 55% of cats are classified as overweight or obese by the veterinarians. Now, they are blaming, of course, fat Americans.
Pet owners.
That's right.
Parents for fat kids, pet owners for fat pets.
That's exactly what they're saying. Fat pet owners, as America gets fatter, we're exercising less, we're walking less, and therefore our animals are exercising less and walking less and getting fatter. This seems to be a major issue in the pet community. I am a pet owner myself. I have two cats and a dog. One of my cats, I would say, is overweight. The other two animals aren't, but she's a little kitten, you know? She's kitten
fat.
It'll
happen. Give it some time.
The problem is not only are more pets overweight than ever before in America, but they're getting fatter. So this isn't just a problem. It's a growing problem. Do you have a pet?
I do not have a pet. I had a girlfriend last year.
And?
But I don't...
Did she get fatter living with you?
Oh, she did. Yeah. They were all fat. We broke the bed twice. But it wasn't even in the middle of a sex act. We were just changing positions. It was disturbing.
Have you broken furniture in front of somebody?
Yeah, actually. Me and my friend Greg always talked about how if you're going to break a chair, it should always happen after you say something like poetic.
Right.
So it'd be like, this day sucks. And then boom. And the same day we talked about that, I was sitting in his backyard on a piece of patio furniture, which are the worst, lawn chairs. And it broke, but it broke slowly. And I was sinking.
Oof.
And everybody's looking at me like, what's wrong with Mike? And I'm like, this day sucks. And I fucking fell onto the floor.
So Mike,
fell on the grass.
60% of Americans are overweight or obese. Our pets are getting fatter. Over 50% of them are fat. And of course, this leads to my next story from WebMD. Doctors are now fat. Over half of doctors in America are overweight. And why is this a big deal? Because they're saying overweight doctors are less likely to tell their patients to diet and exercise because they themselves are fat.
Find
and they don't want to look like
hypocrites. I want to go to those doctors.
So you see,
where are the fat doctors?
The fat doctors, well, they say over 40% of doctors are overweight now.
Right.
Now, when we say overweight, we're not talking about guys that look like me and you.
Yeah,
overweight is a whole different scale.
It's a whole stupid scale.
Right. You and I are obese.
Yeah, we're obese. Yes.
So overweight,
morbidly obese.
Chances are you're talking to an overweight person right now and you don't know it. I always say that the best test is to know if you're overweight or fat. It's stand up, see if your stomach goes over your belt. And then sit down and see if your stomach. If you sit down and your stomach is going well over your belt, you are a fat American and welcome to the party.
That's true. If you're well versed in shirt stretching,
right.
You're fat.
Right.
If you have the phenomenon, which is a phrase I coined for women, that is the sad case where the belly extends further than the breasts. That's the phenomenon. So if you have that, you're a fat woman.
Yeah, you can't have that woman. Breasts. No.
I hate that. Yeah, the last girl had that.
No Tommy and Malden, you were so mean to my friend Steve Brandano today, but I'll put you up on the Fat Guy Show. Give me your height. Yeah. Give me your weight.
5'10", 262.
Beautiful.
I'm a real fat guy.
Oh, I've met you. You are.
Great show, guys. Did any of you get the Burger King onion rings over the weekend for free?
No, I didn't get the free onion rings. I did go to Burger King and just get a Whopper, and it's in a new box, and it seemed to be new, like how they put it together, like different meat and different bread, and I'm hoping that's just a one-time deal because it was not very good.
I'm not a big Burger King fan like John Hine, but the onion rings are a little better. They're not like, you know how the batter was so solid, but they were okay. They're a little bit.
You liked it?
Yeah, it was better.
Did you get the zesty dipping sauce?
No.
Oh, that's the best. That's the whole reason for getting them. I get that zesty dipping sauce even if I'm not getting french fries. I just get it like automatically.
Put that shit on anything.
Yeah, exactly. Hey, Brian in St. Louis, give us your height, give us your weight.
Hey, I am 5'6 and weigh 236.
Okay.
And my bitch is trying to be short and find a fucking pair of pants that fit.
Oh, yeah, listen.
I've got to work.
I'm 5'6", too.
Extra larges and being 5'6", fuck, I have to have a tailor on retainer to get pants to
well,
fit.
Well, Mike, you're too. Mike, you're 5'6", right?
I'm 5'6", and I'm 340, and let me tell you something. The last suit I bought for my brother's baby's christening, 60 portly short. And that's fucked up when they make you buy a portly short suit.
60 portly, the actual size, there wasn't a number. It's just portly
60
short.
60 portly short. That's, you know, that really makes you feel bad about yourself. But the pants were like a pants that could have went around the bumper of the car. It was, so they literally had to take, they had more material taken off the pants than put on the pants.
Well, pants are hard. I mean, look at me. Now I'm not short. I'm 5'10", 5'11", but what happens is fat guys don't have a waist. So I wear basically a size 48, 30, which doesn't exist really.
Yeah, because
it's 48 to get under my stomach. But then the 30's too long because you're not supposed to wear your pants this low.
Yeah, me neither.
So you end up with fat guy crotch, which is that big, airy, just crotchal area. It really, fat guys do need tailors or better fat stores. Now, I know you said Walmart's actually a good
Walmart
spot
is a fantastic place for shirts. The pants, listen, you're going to have trouble with pants. It's just going to be the life of the fat guy. You're going to have a trouble with pants. So, but for shirts, Walmart really hits the spot.
I'm going to do Matt's favorite and take one more phone call before we end the show. And
I'm playing this out already.
Yeah, this is how it works. Carter in Arizona, you have the last word on the fat guy show. Give us your height. Give us your weight.
Yeah, I'm 5'9", and I weigh about 130.
Another skinny guy. What do you want with the fat guy show?
Yeah.
First of all, I think it's fantastic.
Thank you.
Probably one of the most interesting shows on 101 right now.
Thank you.
But I got to say, it seems to me, I've worked in retail and I've worked in food service, it seems like fat white people are just the meanest people on the face of the planet.
Really? I always find fat, well, I don't know about the race, but I find fat people that are usually more jolly.
I'm white. Yeah. Fuck you.
No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, I don't know about that. That was a weird call to go out on, but thank you for liking the show.
Yeah.
Big Mike Sangiamo, thank you so much for taking time out of coming back up here. Go check out your website, breaktheScale.com. Read the book, Fattest Guy in the Room. Guys, you can follow him on Twitter, @FeastMike. Follow me, @SiriusJ. Thank you. The Fat Guy Show. Fat out.
101. In a country where the obese outnumber the skinny, who's looking out for the big guy? Who is willing to sit down and say, I'm not too big, this doorway is too small? When you need someone to say, we're fat, we're here, and we're going to get extra mayo on that. He's large, he's in charge, and he's full of advice. Your fat host, Jason Kaplan.
Good evening, Fat America. What is up? I am your fat host, Jason Kaplan, and welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. It's our third show, and I'm glad to still be here. Joining me tonight is a fat man himself, Uncle Eddie from New Jersey. Welcome to the show, Uncle Eddie.
Nah, I'm from Staten Island. I'm fat, and I go across the state lines and everything. I get it, but yeah, Staten Island, but still fat. Still fat, nonetheless.
Eddie, I always start the show by doing height and weight. I am 5'10", and I weighed in at 279 today.
Nice.
Which is actually a couple pounds down from the last Fat Guy show, so, but still fat. Still fat.
Still fat, man. Still
fat. How about you? What are you weighing?
Let's go. I'm thinking I'm 5'9", last time I was measured, and I believe last time I was weighed, Jesus Christ, what the hell was that? Let's go with 316.
I was going to say, you're definitely over 3.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Sporting the muscle. It's all muscle.
If you want to take a look at what Eddie and I look like, we tweeted out a picture on @SternShow on Twitter and also @TheFatGuyShow. I retweeted. So you could take a look at the two fat guys talking to you right now on the radio.
Nice.
And today I really want to focus on fat fashion. You know, something I've talked about already on my past two Fat Guy shows. And Mad Men was on last night. It's one of my favorite shows. It's a show that's known for style and dress. And, you know, like many shows on TV, you hardly see a fat person on
Absolutely.
It. You know, even though, again, we represent 60% of America, the overweight and the obese. You know, there's not many fat guys on Mad Men. And even the fat guys are what I call TV fat.
Yeah, they're not round enough.
Right.
They're just round enough for them. They're not round enough in real life.
I don't have the actor's name in front of me. There's this poor guy, Harry. He's gotten skinnier on the show.
They probably forced him.
Yeah, right. And in every scene, he's the quote-unquote fat guy on the show,
yeah.
And he's not that fat, but in every scene, he has a donut in his hand, or he's talking about how he needs to go on a diet. You know, it's just it's the fat stereotype.
Absolutely. It's our own racism.
So, getting, you know, dressed in any sense of the word, where to go to shop, what to wear, how to wear it. Literally, I don't know where certain parts of my body are. People tell me you're supposed to wear the pants at the waist. I don't know where my waist is.
That's under your belly.
Under my belly.
Somewhere.
Right. And so there's a lot of issues. So we're going to be talking to a lot of people tonight in the fashion industry. Joining us later tonight, we have the winner of season one of Project Runway, Jay McCarroll.
Cool.
He'll be calling in. He is or was a big guy himself. I think he lost a lot of weight on Celebrity Fit Club. But we'll talk to him because he was heavy. He does design clothes. And he was also on TV, which also has to be nerve-wracking, to be a fat guy on TV with a whole bunch of skinny people. So I want to find out from him, you know, what he thinks about how if fat guys can even look good and what his suggestions would be to dress well. And then later we'll talk to David Renke. He's the VP General Brand Manager of KingSizeDirect.com.
Oh, I love that place.
Yeah, you're a fat guys have a code. We know what we're talking about.
We know where to go. Right. We know where to go.
And that's what this show's about. It's, you know, you're going to learn more. So KingSizeDirect is one of those places that sells, you know, extra large clothing. And there's a lot going on, especially skinny guys. I don't think you have any idea what's going on with fat clothes. No, some elastic they build into everything and special belts and special shirt sizes and designations, the whole world, right?
Skinny guys suck because they can just walk in and get whatever they want.
Right.
Anyway. I like that t-shirt. Nah. Yours.
You know, one year, and he should have known better because he was a fact. Oh, he didn't buy the gift. Artie Lang bought me a huge gift certificate to Abercrombie and Fitch.
Because that's so you.
That's
Jay.
So me. And I had never been to one before. So I went there with a girl I was dating. And I walk in, and there's just pictures of just abs on the wall. Like, it's just, I don't know, they're guy abs, girl abs. There were just abs everywhere.
You and have one ab.
I have one giant.
One giant ab.
Jiggly ab.
Yeah.
And there was literally nothing for me to buy. I mean, there was nothing in the store that fit on my arm, let alone my torso.
Did you walk out with like a wallet?
I walked out with nothing. I walked out with nothing. And And a disgusted girlfriend, actually, is all I walked out with.
You brought a girl to Abercrombie.
We were in the mall. I'm like, oh, I got a five. Sorry, Artie. I'm going to. It's yeah, been my interview. I got a $500 gift certificate to Abercrombie. I was going to go crazy. And nothing. I got nothing.
Did you get to cash it in or something?
And not just, I don't remember what I did with it. I'm sure Artie traded me Yankee tickets for it or something. Artie's a great guy and also a fellow fat guy, so we salute you, Artie.
Artie Lang.
Artie Lang, everybody. Now, I know not just where to shop and how to wear it, but another huge piece of anxiety for guys like you and me. It's just keeping the clothes that we have together.
Oh, absolutely.
And you had a fat moment on your way here today.
Unprompted, didn't even plan on it, wasn't trying to come up with a funny story for the show. I'm opening the fridge. I got dressed. I made sure everything was tight and nice and looking good. And opening the fridge, trying to get something to eat because I'm fat, that's what I do.
Right.
And all I hear is like in my belt. Just snapped right off. Like, literally just... Poof,
yeah.
Right off. And, like, I think a piece is in the fridge. I don't know.
And you were home when this happened?
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, thank Christ. God. Yeah. It was, like, 5 minutes before I was leaving the house.
Has that ever happened to you on the way... or when you were already out?
Oh, yeah. I've had zipper malfunctions, yeah. Belt, everything.
I've had the belt pop, like, when I'm walking. And I've had to, like, you know, just... Start pulling up your pants. And, you know, it's so weird because when you see a fat guy, and even I thought this, like, why are fat guys' pants always falling down?
Oh, I wanted you to bring this up because it pisses me off to no end.
Because it seems like fat guys should, if anything, their pants should be so tight they never fall anywhere.
We look like a bunch of black dudes. It's like all the way down to our ankles. I don't know why that is.
It's because we don't have a waist. We don't wear our clothes right. We're going to get to the bottom of this tonight, but it is embarrassing
to need answers.
The fat guy constantly pulling up his pants.
Always
pulling up his pants. And, you know, I already see we have the lines are full with fashion advice. And I'm going to go to line one real quick. It's Alex in Pennsylvania. Alex, give me your suggestion here. You said every fat guy needs a what? Oh, and also give me your height. Give me your weight, please.
How you doing, Jason? How you doing, Uncle Ed?
What's up, man?
I'm 5'6", good, thanks. I'm 5'6", 236.
Nice.
One piece of article that I'm 37 years old. One piece of article that every fat guy needs, no matter the age, no matter the size, is a sweater vest. Right now, sweater vests are all the rage. They're on the news because of Rick Santorum giving them a bad name because he's always wearing a sweater vest. But here's what it does. If you have a button-down shirt, whether it's short sleeve, long sleeve, you throw a nice sweater vest over it, it gives you a trimmer profile. Depending on the weave of the sweater vest, it can make you a little bit more compact. It can, like, push things in. And what it does, like, for a guy like me, I'm always rushing to get to work. If I put on a wrinkled shirt, a wrinkled button-up shirt, you throw on a sweater vest, no one sees a wrinkle. If you roll up the sleeves, No one knows that it's a wrinkle.
Well, shirt. Alex, you do bring up a great point with layering, which I definitely am always a fan of. Layer. It smooths out the fat and the rolls. But maybe it works for you. I am not a fan of the sweater vest. I've tried the sweater vest. My mom bought me a bunch of sweater vests when I first started interning on the Howard Stern show. And I thought I looked horrible in them. And I have some fat friends that wear them. I don't know. I'm not a huge fan. Eddie, Uncle?
I have like a couple of questions here because I'm not a fan of the sweater vest. Wouldn't that cause more heat around the midsection, thus causing more perspiration, more sweat a little bit?
It depends on what kind of sweater. I mean, some sweater vests are really thick. I usually buy the ones that are really thin, almost a little bit thicker than a t-shirt material.
Okay.
So it doesn't overheat you. And what you can do is I buy mine on dark colors, black, dark brown, dark blue. Mm-hmm. If you do sweat, no one's going to notice anything because you're wearing a dark color. You know, I'll wear a white shirt with a dark sweater vest. I'd be sweating all day. No one's going to know the difference.
Alex, thanks for the advice. I don't know. I'm not a huge sweater vest guy, but you know, maybe this works for him. Maybe it works for certain fat people. I'm not going to make. See, I'm looking at you.
You can study.
And I'm picturing you.
Sucking in.
I'm picturing you in a sweater vest, and I just don't think it looks good.
I'm going to look like a sweater vest sausage. I don't know. I'm going to have just my arms coming out like Barney.
But it does beg the question. Is it possible for fat guys to look good? I mean, is it even possible? Are we just always going to look fat? We're always going to look stuffed into whatever we're wearing. We're always going to look sweaty. And it's kind of a why bother.
It's weird because it's also like we get really only the options we normally get at a store is like, do you want a t-shirt or do you want a t-shirt with a pocket?
Right.
It's like the only two options you have. Right. You have an array of colors that don't look good on fat people at all.
Right. Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Totally.
You walk into a casual male's bright orange, bright yellow, bright blue.
I want to look like a giant pumpkin, please. That's what I want to look like. I'm round already, but let's accentuate it with orange.
And every fat guy t-shirt has a gigantic graphic on it.
You
like even the one you're wearing right now, it takes up your entire chest. I'm wearing a Superman one. This Superman shirt I'm wearing, again, you could check at Stern Show Twitter feed or at Fat Guy Twitter feed. I also have a website, thefatguyshow.com.
And you have the layers. I'm noticing right now.
I'm wearing three layers right now. But this Superman shirt I'm wearing, I mean, this is, you could, in a way, it's a limited edition because you could only get this one in fat guy shirt.
I need it in fat guy size, please.
They only make this Superman shirt in 4XL and up. It's disgusting. It's weird. I got a caller, Tom, who says he knows why there are no fat people on Mad Men. What's going on, Tom?
Hey, Kaplan. What's up, man?
What's up, man? What's your height? What's your weight, bro?
What's my weight?
Height and weight.
6 feet, 330 pounds.
Oh, big
boy. That's a
big boy.
Yeah, I'm a big guy.
Nice. Welcome to the show. You're with friends.
Yeah, listen. The reason there's not many fat guys on that show is because there was no fat people back then. The average weight was like 170 pounds.
It's an interesting point. I mean, I think there's definitely something to it. I watch old movies a lot, and documentaries, and people were skinnier back then. This is pre, chemicals and hydrochlorics, syrups.
Yeah, there's like 10 fat guys in America.
That was it, 10, just 10.
But I will say that there are most TV shows don't have fat people on them. And, I would like to point out that, you know, back in the day, the Three Stooges were fat. Jackie Gleason was fat. Costello was fat.
Some of the biggest stars were fat.
Yeah. So there were fat people.
Fat was funny.
Fat people are terrible to look at, though, so.
Oh, well, thanks.
Fat was, and always, thanks, Tom. Fat was, and always is funny, but I will say I did notice that even, I hate to say it, and they kind of made a joke about it last night on Mad Men, but Joan is looking fat. I mean, I don't know if anyone's seen, Drive, but, Joan, I can't remember her real name right now, but she is, Christina Hendricks. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, even made a joke about it, how she hasn't lost all the baby weight yet.
Yeah, but she's fat in all the right places. You know what I mean? Like, right? I just want to make sure I had
the right set of boobs,
right? I just want to make sure. Thanks.
We got to go to a break soon, but real quick, because I don't think we're going to have time to talk about it with our guests coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Tuxedo rentals.
They suck.
They suck because I know when I walk into a tuxedo rental, they don't have, like, you know, my friends walk in, it's like, oh, we have 14 different tuxes for you to try on. Here you go. Mix and match, blah, blah, blah. I walk in, it's like, okay, they act like they've never seen a fat guy before. It's like, oh, I got to find a 55 long this. And
we got to sew three of the vests together.
Yeah.
That's the only thing we can do.
And there's only one. There's only, it's not like.
Yeah, it's the ugliest piece of shit you ever saw in your life.
And you have to imagine What fat guy was wearing this before me?
The biggest, sweatiest, fattest, not getting married at the damn bride. You know, nothing was happening for this dude.
Yeah, it's so depressing. And it's so I just did this recently and all my friends were done so fast. And then my shirt had to be special ordered and they had to find a this.
Yeah, it's a problem. Right. It becomes a problem.
Oh, it's the worst.
Screw you, skinny people.
Listen, coming up after the break, we have from season one Project Runway, Jay McCarroll, will be calling in to discuss his fat fashion advice. But first, let's take a moment to reflect on some great moments in fat film history.
Great moments in fat film history. With Fat Bastard from Austin Powers.
When you're an overweight child in a society that demands perfection, like your sense of right, wrong, fair and unfair will always be tragically skewed.
Back to the Fat Guy Show. It tastes like chicken. The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan
on Howard 101.
Call 888 Stern 101.
Now, here's Jason Kaplan.
Welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. talking over my tuba. Welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. And, you know, I didn't eat dinner tonight. I've been so nervous about the show tonight. So I want to take this real quick second to salute a new fat innovation.
This week in Fat Innovations.
The Fat Guy Show honors the Doritos Locos Taco from Taco Bell, making an unhealthy product even more unhealthy and delicious.
If I can just, again, stop to thank the geniuses over at Taco Bell, one of my favorite places to eat and one of the cheapest places to eat, by the way, in these hard times. And they have basically taken their food, turned a Dorito into a plate, an edible plate, and put their delicious Taco Bell food inside of a Dorito, and now you can just eat it all together.
It's brilliant.
It's really brilliant, and it's one of those things that's so brilliant that you wonder why it took them this long to get there. Like why hasn't this been happening? Why haven't I been eating everything out of a Dorito? Can you give me one reason why I'm not eating everything out of a Dorito? I can't think of anything.
There's so many flavors to choose from. It would work.
It really would. Taco Bell, I salute you. Now, on the phone, we have somebody.
Now it's time for a fat guest.
I would like to give a very fat welcome to the great Jay McCarroll. Jay, welcome to the Fat Guy Show.
Oh, hello. I'm so excited to be here.
We're excited to have you. Now, you're a former fat guy, I have to say, because you recently lost a lot of weight on Celebrity Fit Club.
Yeah, I lost 2,000 pounds.
Nice. Wisely done. That's great. How are you feeling nowadays?
Oh, I'm doing just well. Just fine, yes. Thanks for asking. I have a question for you, though, first. Why do they always depict fat with a tuba sound?
You know, I didn't put this together. That would be our great, I don't know, what do you call those guys, Al? I don't know what you call those guys.
Imaging producer.
Thank you. John Kerber and Chris Libertini. And I didn't think of the tuba. And when they brought back the tuba, I just shrugged my shoulders and said, guys, that's it. I mean, that's what fat guys sound like. They sound like tubas, I guess.
Big fat tubas.
Now, Jay, thanks for calling in. As you know, tonight we're talking about fat fashion. I'm here with Uncle Eddie, who's a fellow fat guy. And I guess my basic question to you, for all fat guys, is it possible for fat guys to dress well?
No.
Good answer. End the show.
Nope, and thank you for having me.
Let's close it down, folks.
I mean, as long as our buddies at Walmart are carrying tents in their outdoor department, I think we're good to go. I definitely think so. I mean, for myself, I tend to keep kind of a basic wardrobe and then I accessorize it. So there's only so fat your neck or ankles can get. So I think, you know, amping up your shoes or your socks or your accessories, scarves, hats, that's always a good rule of thumb. But, you know, at the end of the day, I kind of just don't care what people wear. If they want to wear sweatpants all day, more power to them, you know?
Right. But you were, now, this is interesting. You were on television, and by the way, I love the show. And you were heavy back then. Do you remember how much you weighed when you were on?
Well, it depends on which TV show we're talking about.
I'm talking specifically season one, Project One, Runway.
Probably about 250.
Probably about 250. Now, you're on TV. Almost everyone around you was rail thin. I'm sure you wanted to look good. I mean, you're on TV representing fashion, and so you must have put together, I remember you look good. You were always wearing something cool. So you weren't just tooling around in sweatpants.
Well, I've taken 20 years to cultivate my style.
Yeah.
I do have my little smoke and mirror tricks to hide my big fat gut. So, I collect clothes. I'm a hoarder of clothing and fabric, and for God's sakes, I can make my own clothes if I want to. So that's actually how I kind of got started designing clothes, is because I was a fat kid and I'd have to shop at the Husky department at Sears. Mm. And my inseam to waist ratio, I had probably like a 34 waist at, 10 years old, and my legs were short. So mm-hmm. My mother had to hem my pants. So actually that's kind of how I started to design. So I kind of blame my gut for my abilities in the fashion design world.
No, I was going to say, can we stop right here on the inseam part? Because this is something I have a problem with. Anyone at home, if you're by a computer, go check out thefatguyshow.com. I put up pictures of what I call my crotchal region. And Jay, what this is that I don't have a waist. I don't know where I'm supposed to wear my pants. Is it below the belly or above the belly? And, I'm about a 30 or the 32 length. And so whatever I wear, I end up getting a lot of bag air in the crotch. I get my pants go over my shoes. You can't ever see what shoe I'm wearing because it's just covered by the bottom of my pants. So what am I to do?
Find a good tailor.
Yeah.
Find someone to just sew for you. Or just cut them off, and who gives a shit,
Well, okay, pretend I give a shit, because I do. Is that real? I mean, would you suggest that fat guys who want the clothing to fit properly are really, at the end of the day, going to have to get them tailored?
Most likely, yeah. There are shops out there that cater to those kind of things. I mean, someone like an Old Navy, you can definitely find a pair. Am I allowed to plug stores? I'm not really plugging them, I'm just mentioning them.
Yeah, just tell whatever your advice is,
Yeah. Somewhere like an Old Navy, their pants will go up to a 38, 40, 42, with a 30, 32 inseam. So, but then, even shopping online, there are places that have a bigger size range. I know, mm-hmm. Old Navy or Levi's or something will go up higher online, but not necessarily in the store. And of course, you have your big and tall men's shops all across the country. So the issue is that, your larger people tend to have a tendency to have a rounder waist and maybe not as much of a butt. And, typically their legs aren't gigantic. So you're kind of having to fit all of these different ratios around your body, kind of based off of your waist size, which isn't necessarily fair. Right now I'm wearing a pair of Old Navy trousers. I keep plugging them. A pair of Old Navy trousers they're called slim cut khakis, and I find them to be perfect because they're slim through the leg, but they have some girth in the waist. So, looking for something that's like a slim fit, but in a bigger size, they cut them to fit your body a little better.
That's cool. Now, do you wear, or am I supposed to wear the pants? Again, there's a picture of this up on thefatguyshow.com. I wear my pants under the belly. I've seen older gentlemen usually sometimes wear it above the belly. Okay, you're left. So it's definitely below the belly, right?
I would let the overhang hang.
Hang.
If I were you. Because you don't want to look like Humpty Dumpty, and have, I see that too with these older dudes, and it's like there's like 2 inches between their tits hanging down.
Your tits can't meet your belt. Right.
Hey, my tits!
And I will say to stay away from, even though, if you're trying to hide your gut, stay away from pleats in the front, pleated front pants, because they make your gut look even bigger. So try to stay with a flat front. Do you know what that is? Like a flat front trouser doesn't... You know what a pleat is?
I know,
I'm getting like a fashion course here.
Yeah, you are a little bit, yeah.
Yeah. So stay away from pleats because they have a tendency to make you look wider. You see these like thin guys who have like a 30-inch waist who like, go to their business and they can wear plaid or pleated front pants, but we can't, so...
Now, how have you ever, and I can't remember if this was your season or not, but have you ever designed clothes specifically for a heavier person?
I did. I did a line on QVC, which went up to 4X.
So, oh, great.
Yeah. You know, I'm still just up and coming, and it takes so much more fabric for the fatties. No, I'm kidding. it's definitely something that's in the pipeline, of course. So I have tons of larger fans, and they're all so mean to me, saying, "Why did you make clothes for us?" But one day I will.
Yes, please do. Now, if you want to see what Jay's working on and all his great fashion, you could check out jaymccarrollonline.com. That's Jay, J-A-Y, and McCarroll, M-C-C-A-R-R-O-L.
Do it again!
M-C-C-A-R-R-O-L-L. Online.com, and you can follow him on Twitter at Jay McCarroll, JayMccarroll. Everyone got
can
that?
Tell one more story?
Can yes.
Tell,
more story? Tell more stories, please.
My sister lives in Denver, Colorado, mm-hmm. and she works with a gentleman who's 400 pounds.
Okay.
And she was wearing one of my scarves around Christmas time, and he just loved it, and he thought it was so great. So she bought him one for Christmas, and he gets so many compliments on it, and he's a larger guy, so he can't, you know, necessarily rock one of my weirdo t-shirts.
Right.
But, you know, he got this scarf and it's a perfect accessory for him. So, I mean, always stock up on scarves and hats and all sorts of different accessories. And those you can find at, insert plug here, www.jaymccarroll.com.
That's right. And so that seems to be my biggest takeaway from talking to you is accessorize. It's the hats, it's the scarves, it's cool looking shoes. And is that to draw the eye away from the fat and kind of say, hey, look at anything but the fat? Or does that really just kind of help put the look together?
I think it's kind of like the cherry on top of the sundae kind of thing. And yeah. And also stick with darker colors. You know, hardly anybody can wear white unless you're some little fag on a cruise ship or something.
Speaking of a cruise ship, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
So you at one time you were selling clothes in Amsterdam, right?
I was.
So you were over there in Europe.
Yeah.
Okay, so you know, I've been to Europe before. Europe is not a fat man's friend. Is this correct?
That is true. Well, maybe since our American fast food restaurants have invaded Europe, I think they are getting a little heavier.
If you ever try and use a public restroom in Europe or anything, everything is just built for guys that are 5'8" and 100 pounds.
Well, when I was living there, I just shit on the street. So I didn't know.
When in Rome.
Who do you think, who can you point to as maybe someone famous fat, like a John Goodman or a Jack Black, who you say, yeah, you know what, that person always looks good?
You're throwing me for a loop here. That wasn't in our pre-
Sorry, I just thought. I just thought of it.
Damn it!
Where's my script?
I'll tell you what, let me change it. While you think about it, let me take a phone call. Let's see if we have
Is it Cedric the Entertainer?
Yeah, Cedric. Yeah.
Yeah. There's one of those guys who's like a big guy. He always has like a fedora on.
I think that's Cedric. Yeah,
it's him, yeah.
Is Cedric still alive?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah,
yes.
Bernie Mac died.
Oh, Bernie Mac. Okay, sorry.
Well, that's okay. A lot of fat comedians are passing.
And they all wear suits with like 74 buttons in the front. That's all right.
Oh, I just lost my call.
They wear like lavender shoes.
Yeah, well, their black guys can pull that off.
I know.
There's different groupings for different people. That's the problem.
Chris from Pittsburgh, you're on the air. You have some questions about fashion. What's your height? What's your weight?
Well, I was telling the call screener, my height is 5'10", and I presently weigh 220 pounds. But
congratulations.
At my heaviest, I was at 272. So I can relate. I certainly appreciate the show, Jay. I think you do a fantastic job.
Thanks.
I just wanted to relay a little fashion story. Today, I wore an Adidas sweatsuit with an Adidas shirt. I look like a total tool. but my wife made mention. She said, you know, because you look like somebody really important today. And all I could think was, at 272, all I would have looked like was the guy that was waiting for the hot sign to go on at Krispy Kreme, which I did on many, many occasions. So I just think the fashion, you know, you got a fat guy that's 330, 5'8", and he's wearing an Adidas sweatsuit, warm-up suit. We look totally different. So I think it's interesting, and I agree with you, Jason, that, you know, you go to buy a tux or you go to rent a tux, and you just feel like you're on your own island.
Yep. Yeah. Everyone just deserts you. You're in a whole different world, a whole different section of the store. It's not fun. Hey, one more call for Jay here. Let's see, where's CWB? CWB in Tennessee, you have any fashion advice?
You kind of stole my thunder a little bit with the kingsizedirect.com.
Oh, yeah, he'll be calling in later in the show. Is that where you get your clothes?
Yeah, that's where I got all my clothes and stuff. But you mentioned fat moments earlier. I had the fat moment to trump all fat moments Friday before last. I got fired from my trucking job because I'm too fat to drive a truck.
Really? How fat are you?
I weigh 560 pounds.
And what was the, you couldn't get in a truck or?
No, what it was is the guy said that my attitude was, quote-unquote, unmanageable, and I complained too much, and he said the reason why my attitude was that was because I was too fat.
Hmm. What? That sounds a little weird there. I don't know. Hey, Jay, question for you. One last one before we let you go.
Yes.
Suspenders, yes or no?
I would say no.
You would say no. All right. So, Jay, what I'm walking away from is, you know, even though I have no waist, I'm still under my stomach. You know, get a tailor if I really want my pants to look good. Accessorize. Visit jmccarrollonline.com and visit you on Twitter.
I have one last piece of advice. One last piece.
Please. We love it.
Suit coats. They're great.
What coats?
Suit, like a sport coat, like a suit coat, like a blazer.
You know, that's kind of the look I wanted to go to. So can I, okay, so fat guy, blazer. Now, what's the difference real quick? I know this is turning into a complete fashion show. Is there a difference between a sports coat and like a regular suit jacket?
I just call them all the same
thing. They're all the same thing? And you could just wear those with like a t-shirt and jeans or something? Or no?
Yeah, because the like with a button down, if you wear a button down underneath a suit coat, that's even better. Because anything that kind of makes the eye go up and down is really good for you. So if you wear a suit coat and it, you know, you have a little bit of opening showing like an undershirt, t-shirt, button down kind of thing. And if you're larger, you have a tendency to be wider, so your eye kind of plays an optical illusion when you wear a suit coat because you're kind of blocking off a good quarter of your gut expansion side to side. So that's my trick.
Oh, I like that. I like that. A sports coat and then the button-down shirt underneath still untucked though, right?
I mean, if you're comfortable with wearing it tucked in, you don't mind a little bit of puffiness, then go for it. I don't do it. I let my shirt out and then I look nice and long.
Nice. That's how I
then you get in bed with me and you're like, what the fuck? You are totally hiding this the whole time.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? I know it's going to let you go, but I got one last question on the line here. Wesley from Colorado, give us your height. Give us your weight.
I'm 6'2", 260.
Nice. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, I was just wondering, summer's coming up and everything, and there's a lot of pool parties, especially I live in a college town. And I was just wondering, what can you do other than sit at the edge of the pool with your feet in the pool?
I'll answer that first. I mean, for me, you got to make a decision. You're either going to enjoy yourself and go swimming or you're not. I'm not one of the guys that wears their shirt in the pool. I think that just draws attention to how fat and disgusting I am.
I do.
You do?
Damn it.
Yeah, well, because, you know, before you go in the pool, it's fine. It's after when it's all wet and sticking to you.
Well, you got to get one of those, like, those sport, even though we're fat, we buy sports clothes a lot.
Right.
And you have to get one of those kind of vented shirts where the water kind of just goes right through.
That's not a bad
one. You get the sleeveless, you know, you look like you're tough, but you're not.
Jay, how do you, Summer?
Oh, I just wear like a head-to-toe, like body glove surfing thing, and
there you go.
And then everyone thinks I'm just surfing, and that's acceptable. Or I'll just wear a Speedo thong, and I'll wear a little necklace that says "Stop staring at me."
It's banana hammock.
Jay, yes. Thank you so much for calling in. I hope you get up here live sometime. You have tons of great advice for everybody, and I really appreciate you making the time to call in.
Yes, and for everybody out there, just do what you want to do in life. Who gives a shit what other people think? Really, at the end of the day, who cares?
Well, that's what the show here is for. It's not so much, hey, we're fat and we're ashamed by it, but we're fat and how do we make the best of how we look? And I know some people care. I know I've never wanted to become one of those fat guys like we heard on the phone that has, you know, wears the Adidas full outfit and everything like that. And, you know, I put something on and it never looks right. And I know it never will look right as long as I'm heavy, but... But these are some great tips you've given, and I really appreciate it, so thank you. And check out jmccarrollonline.com for all of Jay's clothing and everything that he's up to, and you can follow him on Twitter, @jmccarroll. And Jay, thanks so much for everything, brother.
You are more than welcome. All the best to you.
Thank you. You too. And we're going to go out to break, and when we come back, we have David Renke. He is the brand manager at King Size Direct. But first...
Great moments in fat film history with Fat Bastard from Austin Powers.
Of course I'm no happy. Look at me, I'm a big fat slob. I've got bigger titties than you do. I've got more chins than a Chinese phone book. I've not seen my willy in 2 years, which is long enough to declare I'm legally dead. I can't stop eating. I eat because I'm unhappy. I'm unhappy because I eat. It's a vicious cycle. If you'll excuse me, there's someone I have to get in touch with and forgive. Myself. Sorry, I farted.
Back to the fat. It's the Fat Guy Show.
Watch out, fat boy.
Oh my God, he's huge.
He makes sumo wrestlers look healthy.
We're back with the Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan on Howard 101.
Call 888-STERN-101. Now, here's Jason Kaplan. Because I'm fat, fat,
fat. Come on. Hey, welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. I am Jason Kaplan. Call in 888-STERN-101. That's 888-783-7610. And you can follow the show on Twitter at The Fat Guy Show and at my website, thefatguyshow.com. Sitting here with Uncle Eddie. Uncle.
Hello.
How you doing?
I'm doing good.
We got some really good fashion advice in that last segment from Jay McCarroll.
I learned a lot, actually. I really did.
Yeah, I think I'm going to go for the sports coat thing. He suggested, if you just missed it, he suggested sports coats are a good look for fat guys, accessorizing hats, scarves.
I'm a big fan of the sport coat. I actually have a couple.
Do you?
For that exact reason. It works. Instant dress up.
That's
instant.
Excellent. I like that because, yeah, I can wear all my different t-shirts under it and, yeah.
It all works. I think it all works.
And you know what? We have someone on the line right now who might know a thing or two about large size jackets.
Now it's time for a fat guest.
Joining me now on the Fat Guy Show is the brand manager for King Size Direct Clothing. That's kingsizedirect.com, David Renke. David, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Now, you're not actually a fat guy. I looked you up this afternoon. You're a skinny guy in a fat guy's world.
That is absolutely correct, and I'm glad to be here.
Okay, well, we'll take you because, you know, listen.
We need all the help we can get.
Yeah, my whole take is, look, I'm a fat guy. I'm not saying that I'm proud of it or everyone should be fat, but we're here. We're 60% of America. We're overweight. We're obese. Maybe that's not a good thing. Maybe it is, but it's a fact of the matter right now. This is what's going on. And it is why I am shocked that there aren't more outlets for fat guy clothing. Our last guest, Jay McCarroll, hinted on it, like, oh, yeah, you know, some places have some XLs or they don't carry them in the store, but if you go online, they have it. But I can't believe it's not more mainstream, and thank God I found King Size Direct. I order from you guys all the time. Why do you think it's not more mainstream?
Well, first of all, you know, you say thank God you found us. We get letters every day from not only customers but family members of customers saying, thank God I had nowhere else to shop. You know, I can't completely explain it, but I do know, like, you can walk into most any store and buy a 2XL shirt, but once you get 2XL, 3XL, it becomes niche really quick. And, you know, a lot of retailers have shied away from carrying the bigger sizes because they just don't want to be stuck with all the inventory if no one buys it. But, you know, my only recommendation for folks is go to the internet, because it's really turned what used to be an absolutely impossible situation into a relatively manageable one.
Yeah, and that's actually where I first found you guys, and I signed up and I got the catalog and it comes home. And it's funny, once you know you sign up for one fat guy thing on the internet. I got a ton of fat guy things. I got the fat guy furniture and the fat guy this, which is fine, because again, you know, in the retail store. And so, for example, I'm jumping all over the place. I apologize. I would imagine that one of the things that's hard for a fat guy retailer is the stigma of shopping in a fat guy store, because I wasn't born a fat guy. I've turned into a fat guy. I've always been an XL, but it wasn't until my mid-20s where I started the XL, went from 2XL to 3XL to 4XL. And I resisted going to an XL-only retailer for a long time, and it wasn't until I was in Macy's one day, and the two X's were just not fitting me, and I had, like, a hissy fit. I freaked out.
I threw a tantrum.
Yeah, I threw a tantrum. I'm not lying. But what I realized later, I was only mad at myself for getting as heavy as I did, and that really began my whole, okay, well, now I got to go find places like a king-size director, these other places, and... It was hard to take that first step in the door, but I'm glad I did, because nothing makes you look better than feeling good in the clothes you're wearing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly what we find. You know, there's absolutely a stigma to being a big guy, and having to shop at a special store doesn't really make it any easier. So what we found is some guys have zero problem with it. These guys just... You know, they walk in and I say, we're ready to go. But others, it's exactly what you said. They get somewhere between 2X and 3X and they're not really sure what to do and they're hesitant to make that switch. But, you know, what you described is the exact same experience what our customers tell us. You know, once they've come over, it's just too easy and convenient versus trying to, like, go to the department store and hunt and look at me, you know, for anything that fits.
So yeah, no, that's totally true. Now, how's your shopping experience been, Uncle?
I have been fat my whole life, so I've been husky. I've been that guy, Dave. I've been that guy. I understand, and I thank you for being around. And places like your company, I need that because we don't have a place to shop. Growing up, when you're a kid, you have nothing that fits, and you're a fat kid in school, and you want to just fit in, and you don't have anything that you fit in. So it doesn't work at all, and this is what you need. I have these catalogs all over the place.
Yeah. So, David, I want to bring to the world what's going on with Fat Guy Clothes that they might not know about, and maybe you could tell us some stuff that I don't know about. Now, one of my favorite things when I buy pants from you guys or the other retailers is that Fat Guy pants, yeah, I get them in the 48, but they have a built-in elastic.
Right.
And what that does is it allows the pants to kind of grow with you a little bit. You're not going to take it to a 54, but, you know, they're kind of saying, like, hey, you know, you're a big guy. It also works for me in the way that, you know, my stomach is one dimension standing up, and then sitting down, it's a whole other dimension. Is this something, David, that has been around for a long time, and is it something that you see growing?
It's a huge... Getting the waist right for big guys is the number one issue. And I mean, you described it exactly right. If you're a 5X, your size can literally fluctuate plus or minus 10 pounds pretty easily.
Mm-hmm.
So that creates a huge wardrobe problem for, you know, sitting, you know, when you have a meal, anything like that. So what we found is that the waist treatments, you know, the more options we offer the guy, the better. And we find that most guys kind of find one that works best for them. So we have side elastic, hidden inner side elastic, inner stretch waistband, and then we have full elastic waistbands, which are really, quite frankly, the most comfortable.
Right.
Not always the most stylish, but, you know, the truth is, for most of the time, for most people, comfort, you know, trumps style, especially if you don't have to tuck in your shirt.
And now I have a question to stay on the pants angle.
Yeah.
I'm naive when it comes to clothes. Maybe it's not just a fat guy thing, but I think it is. It has a special compartment where you could put the belt, where the belt doesn't have to go through all the loops on the outside. It could just go on the inside.
Right.
You know what I'm talking? Is that a fat guy thing? Or is that just a nice pants thing and I'm just a rube?
Jason, you got outside my realm there. I'm not sure of the answer on that one.
My producer is shaking his head like he has no idea what I'm talking about. You don't know what I'm talking about?
I really don't know what you're talking
about. Okay, so
no one knows.
I'm wearing pants I bought from you guys right now. So I have two belt loops, okay? So I put the belt, I start putting the belt through the outside loop and then another outside loop.
Yeah.
And then there's a little tunnel and it goes inside.
Okay. Here's the deal. So imagine, you know, you've got six belt loops for a really skinny guy who's like a 32 waist.
Right.
You put six belt loops on a 60-inch waist, and those things are going to snap. So
it is a fat guy thing.
So you can either go more loops, or you can make them more tunnel-esque, is really the answer.
This is why we need stores like you. You're thinking about this stuff. I love it.
We're living it.
We're living it, man.
Okay, so I asked Jay McCarroll, who was our last guest on, maybe you have a thought on this. One of my other big issues is balloon crotch. You know, I wear my pants below the stomach, and they're too long. How do I help combat
okay,
that?
So I want to hear what Jay said. I wasn't able to listen in beforehand. I apologize.
No, Jay said find a good tailor.
Go find a good tailor. No, forget that.
Yeah.
So here, I looked at the picture online that you posted, and I think you've come to a make or break decision, and my recommendation is to you, you're going to have to go back up to your natural waist and pull those pants up above and change the size, because the reason you've got extra crotch is because you're wearing well below your natural waist.
Right.
And that's what's creating the problem. That's why the pants not fitting correctly.
But I don't know if I could pull my pants up higher. I'm not joking. I don't know if there's anywhere for it to go.
You couldn't pull it above your waist? Like,
I don't know. I really thought
mine is.
I'm freaking out right now. Wait, let me see where your pants are. I don't have it up that high. I got it under. So you got
your belly goes.
Oh, I'm going to try and do this right
he's
now.
Gonna
on
try, he's going to try to tuck his belly in his pants. Oh,
I'm tucking my stomach in.
Well,
wait, they're sending in help.
Yeah. Is this my waist, Jim?
Here we go.
Maybe I'm wearing the wrong size pants, you're saying?
You're probably wearing too small of a pant. So what you need to do, here's what I recommend you do.
Okay.
If you go to our website, go buy a pair of our knockarounds. Again, it's not the most stylish pant, but it's a full elastic pant. And then you can experiment with it and wear it. That way it has a lot more give, and try wearing it on your natural waist. So, you know, you basically pull it over your belly a bit. And you would obviously not wear this with a tucked in shirt.
Right.
You definitely will find that you're never going to have this crotch problem again.
You don't crotch problem. The only time that you don't want more crotch is this problem.
Yeah.
That's right.
Balloon crotch, crotchal area. I thank you for the advice. I actually have my pants pulled up now and it feels good, but I also feel my stomach pushing the pants away. I know this isn't going to last. I'm probably going to have to lift them up every time I stand up.
Yeah, again, I think if you get a different pant, or if you don't have any elastic in that pant, you might find that, you know, you need a pant with some elastic in it. The other thing to keep in mind is if you've got skinny legs, you never want to buy the loose fit pant. You want to get the right size pant for your belly, but don't get loose fit through the legs, because basically that means you've got, it's presuming that you've got fat legs too. If you don't have fat legs, you don't want the loose fit. You want the regular fit.
Regular fit. Actually, Jay McCarroll suggested slim fit. Also for the legs if you have skinny legs. So I have a question. Another one. I know it's going to sound silly, but listen, I'm just talking from experience.
Yeah.
Being a fat guy, I spill a lot. I'm constantly dropping food. I noticed that a lot of the fat guy clothing does come stain resistant. Is that on purpose?
Well, it's not because big guys spill on themselves more. That's what you're asking.
We're rushing to eat.
You know what it is? What we find is that it's so hard for our guys to find stuff that when they do, they want it to last.
Right.
You know, so basically, you know, we found that if we can put some stain treatment on it, let it last longer, get the stains out, it's just, everyone's a lot happier. Because, you know, I don't know if you're our typical customer or not, but our typical customer, when they find a shirt they like, they buy five of it.
I'm your typical customer.
There you go.
And then they want to take care of it and they want it to last.
Right.
So we put the stain treatment on there and it seems to be something that our customers like.
What, just a curiosity, I don't know if you know the answer offhand, but you're an online only retailer, correct?
Yep.
And which is great. It's Kings Online Direct?
It's King Size Direct.
King Size Direct. Sorry, I lost my plug in front of me. KingSizeDirect.com. And they send the catalog in the mail.
Yes, I love the catalog.
I love the catalog. It's the only catalog I get. I feel excited.
We started as a catalog company, originally, and we still send catalogs. That's the main way we communicate with our customers. But a lot of our customers still pick up the phone and call us, which we like that too.
I was going to say, now that is something I haven't done, but if I call, there's a customer service also number up on the website. Someone will talk to you and give you advice?
Absolutely. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And you guys go up to 10XL, correct?
Yeah. We're, as far as we know, we're the only kind of mainline big and tall retailer that goes up to 10XL in virtually everything that we make. We kind of, you know, we've made a commitment over here that, you know, if we're going to serve a 4X guy or 5X guy, we're not just going to cut it off because we don't think there's enough of the bigger guys. So we go to a higher size level in more items than anybody else, and we're kind of proud of that.
Great. Hey, Dave, hold on. I'm going to take some phone calls. I don't know if they're all directed at you, but don't go anywhere. I'm having a great time talking to you.
No problem.
Hey, Mark from San Diego, give us your height, give us your weight.
5'8", 160.
All right, and what do you want to talk about on the Fat Guy Show?
Hey, Jason, here in San Diego, Jack in the Boxes, banners, this whole thing, bake and shake, even as a bong-ripping fat dude like you, is that too much?
a bacon shake. I am not one of those guys that needs to have bacon in everything, and I love bacon. Don't get me wrong.
Bacon.
I love bacon. And I love actually bacon salt somebody sent me, but I don't need bacon in, you know, everything. That's my personal take. And I like milkshakes. I just want to taste like a milkshake.
I try it. I can't say I wouldn't try
right.
it. It's a, I mean, it's all right. So it's bacon milkshake is what you're saying.
There is.
That's a, that sounds simple.
Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't you try it and call us back and for the next Fat Guy show, give us a review.
Fuck that. Then I'll be a fat guy.
Well, you know, it takes one to know one, bro.
Come on.
You got to get in on it.
Embrace your inner fatness.
Big J from Philly, you're on the Fat Guy show. Give us your height. Give us your weight.
Oh, what's up, Jay? 6'5", 340.
Nice.
I love your show, Jay. You're great. You're one of my favorite people. I graduated high school at 6'5", 200 pounds. Then I had a disease and I went to 500 pounds. And so I live life of like a skinny built guy to a really a monstrous fat guy. Now I'm just a fat guy. I'm finding it hard to let go of my clothes. I don't know if you had that problem, Jay, like throughout your weight and size and everything, but I go to big and tall man in casual male. So with these guys online, I'm glad I'm listening to it because I never even knew that these guys were out there. So like, how do I get a catalog?
Well, first you want to go to kingsizedirect.com. They have a great website. It's very easy to navigate. And I don't know, David, is there any other way you should get in touch with you guys?
That's the best way. But can I give all your listeners a great coupon as well?
Yeah, I guess so.
Okay, so if you're listening and you've got your pen and you're a big guy and you want to try out our store, it's only going to work till tomorrow midnight because we can't have this code all over the internet.
Okay.
It's a coupon code that gets you 40% off your entire order, and here it is. It's KSFATGUY40, and that'll get you 40% off your entire order until midnight tomorrow night. So we welcome you to give us a try if you haven't already.
Oh, wow, very nice.
Sweet.
Thank you. Are you going to go
Thank
try
you
that
very
out?
Much.
Big J, call back in the next Fat Guy show. Let us know how shopping worked out for you and what you bought, okay?
I will, Jay. Thanks, right. Man.
Hey, David, that's awesome. What can you tell us? Is there anything new in XL trends or like we were talking about some of the technology innovations or even what's coming up for summer? What's coming up right around the corner?
I'll tell you. I spoke with our designers about this issue. I knew you were going to ask. The truth is, it's slim pickings, and I mean that literally. Unfortunately, the big trend in menswear, and it's been going on for a while, is making everything skinny. We're talking skinny pants, suits. And let me tell your listeners one piece of advice. Don't go there. This trend is going to peter out, and until then, stick to the classics. Khakis, polo shirts, plaid shirts. And the only other thing I tell you is if you're a big guy and you're not wearing cargo pants, they're always great because they tend to balance out the big guy silhouette. So, you know, like I mentioned before, if you have a fuller stomach and thinner legs, adding those pockets actually really helps even out the shape.
Wow. Cargo pants. Oh, I see what you're saying because, yeah, your pants will kind of get almost as wide as your stomach and then it won't look as weird.
Yeah, you don't want to have the Humpty Dumpty look.
Yes.
I like hiding food in the pockets.
Can you tell from online what parts of the country are your strongest sellers?
You know, we've done this analysis so many times because you hear that there are certain regions of the country that are bigger, and for those of us that have to travel some with our jobs or on vacations, it looks like you see that there are places
right.
that are bigger, but we actually don't really see much of a trend. We are finding that we have strong sales all over the country. And in fact, we just recently started shipping internationally, and you know, we get orders from Kuwait, New Zealand. I mean, the big and tall population is exploding everywhere.
And that is my point. This is why this show exists. This is why KingSizeDirect.com exists. You know, not saying it's a great thing to be fat. It certainly isn't healthy, but it is a fact of life. And we eat. And work and dress and we have to get by. And, it's places like kingsizedirect.com and Jay McCarroll giving us some great advice and all our fat friends out there who help make our lives easier. Thank you very much, David.
Hey, thanks so much for having us. Great to be here.
You too. We'll talk to you soon, hopefully. And, so as we're coming up to the end of the Fat Guy show here. We've learned a lot. We've learned how to dress, or at least some advice. We've learned that,
accessories,
hats and scarves and that's all good. While we're doing the show, a very disturbing report came across my desk. And, Al, do we have a news something to play real quick? So I'm actually going to pick up on the caller that called in with this. Sharp in St. Louis, you're on the air. Can you give me this disturbing news?
The disturbing news is that, and as a liberal, I'd like to ask you this, Jason. Mm-hmm. Is this enough? Is this enough, Jason?
Tell us what it is. Tell us what it is.
Due to pressure from Michelle Obama's anti-obesity initiative, Mars Candy Bars will not be having king-size candy bars anymore. No candy bars over 250 calories, Jason. This is egregious.
Well, Sharp.
Is this enough to
Sharp's out of breath.
Yeah, Sharp is clearly a fat guy because he's out of breath. Hey, Sharp, I forgot to ask you your height and weight real quick.
At my heaviest, I'm about six foot 230. But
6'2", 230. He's on kind of a bad phone. He says 6'2", 230, and he called in with a story that Michelle Obama.
This
you
is
know,
horrible.
She's healthy, and she put the I guess she twisted the arms of the candy bar industry, and they've done away with king size candy. Now, I am actually a fan of Michelle Obama's war on obesity.
Oh, yeah.
I have no problem with people saying get healthy, and quite frankly, I'm a little bit more pissed off at the candy bar companies for folding.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how I'm feeling. I mean, Snickers, don't bite the hands that feed you.
We're the ones that are buying your food.
Yeah. I mean, I love a king size Snickers. Like literally, that's the best candy bar ever in the history of candy bars.
Wipe the drool.
I know.
Wipe
the drool. Take it.
You got a little drool.
And what they're, and I've noticed, I haven't so much noticed that the king size have disappeared. What I have noticed is that they've been doing this thing where instead of getting the king size Snickers, you just get two Snickers in one pack.
Yeah. It's like, and a fun size.
Yeah, and I guess I'm reading now that this is the workaround. This is how the candy bar companies are getting
the loophole.
Yeah, but I don't want two Snicker bars.
Well, no, you do want two Snicker bars. Let's cut the shit. We all want two Snickers bars.
My point is, if I wanted two Snicker bars, I'd buy two Snicker bars. The king size was like nothing else. It was just huge. It was like a huge, I know it sounds gross, but it was just a huge giant turd in your hand. It was just caramel and chocolate and peanuts and nougat and
turd with nuts.
I don't know. I'm really not a fan of this, and I really don't think it is necessarily going to work. I mean, McDonald's got rid of Super Size Me because of Morgan Spurlock. I don't think they went anywhere.
This might be the way that we stimulate the economy, because now the fat guys of the world have to buy more than one candy bar.
Maybe that's
so. If every fat guy buys two times the candy, we're gonna actually bring it up.
Hey Grant, you're fat in Toronto. What's your height? What's your weight?
Hey man, 6'1", 160. My heaviest was 260. The worst was wearing stretch pants. I got tired of it. I started walking, started running, ran two marathons, got down to 160, man. So it's possible if you want to lose weight. You just got to eat right and exercise. No gimmicks, no nothing. Just anybody can do it. You got to say no to the stretch pants.
Hey, Grant, thank you. That was Grant with a very positive message.
I couldn't hear him. I was eating.
We're already at the end of the Fat Guy Show. I'd like to say thank my guest, Jay McCarroll from Project Runway. You could visit him on jmccarrollonline.com and on Twitter at jmccarroll.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, from King Size Direct, their brand manager, David Renke. You could visit them at kingsizedirect.com. They sell fat clothes. Uncle Eddie, thanks for joining me. We could find your ham radio show where?
MoreLikeRadio.com, and my Twitter is UncleEddie13.
I'd like to welcome Jonah Hill back to Fat. Peace out.
Howard 101.
In a country where the obese outnumber the skinny, who's looking out for the big guy?
Who is willing to sit down and say, I'm not too big, this doorway is too small? When you need someone to say, we're fat, we're here, and we're going to get extra mayo on that. He's large, he's in charge, and he's full of advice. Your fat host,
Jason Guy Show. I am your fat host, Jason Kaplan. And I'll just hand it some horrible, horrible news right at the top of the show. I was going back and forth with my guest and my producer about whether or not Citi Field had an all-you-can-eat food section. And I thought they did. I was all gearing up to go out to a game and see if I could put that to the test. But I'm being told that Citi Field does not indeed have an all-you-can-eat section. Not yet, anyway. I'm going to get on top of them about that soon. Welcome to the Fat Guy Show. Call in 888-STERN-101. That's 888-783-7610. And we are talking fat sports on today's show. Joining me in a few minutes will be Chris Carlin from the SNY Network. Chris is a big boy like myself, but he is a success. He has climbed to some of the highest heights of cable television, local, and we'll get to all of his stuff. But I want to just check back in with the audience. It's been a month since our last show. I am still losing weight, but not as much as I had been. I think I only lost a pound or two since I last joined you guys. And I blame this weekend. This weekend I went crazy, and actually specifically blame Sam Simon, because he called into the Howard Stern show screaming about meat and fast food, and all I could get, I couldn't get steak out of my head. Like, it was just, he somehow put steak on Wednesday afternoon into my head, and just, it was all I could think about this weekend. I don't know if it was the images of the cows being horribly slaughtered or John Hine fighting for himself. But anyway, so I had steak, I had potatoes, I made homemade Oreo ice cream, I made spaghetti and sausage. It was not a good weekend for losing weight. So I packed it in, and it was a fat weekend. So call in. I want to know your height. I want to know your weight. I want to know it all. But let's start the show. Oh, with thanking my beautiful, beautiful sponsors, King Size, the big and tall experts. Visit kingsizedirect.com. I just got my King Size catalog this weekend, and I went through it. I'll talk about that coming up in the show. But first, without further ado, hit it out.
Now it's time for a fat guest.
The man you hear laughing is Chris Carlin. If you're not from the New York area, you might not be 100% sure who he is, but he is from the SNY network. Chris, that is like the Mets network. That's the Mets cable network here on the East Coast. Welcome to the Fat Guy Show.
Thanks for having me, man. This is a thrill.
I am so excited. Chris and I have known each other through Twitter for a while now. We've wanted to do the show together at some point. Chris, you were like one of the first guys I thought of. Not because you're fat, but all right.
No, because I'm fat.
Yeah, because you're fat. And you're a successful fat guy, and that's what I love. You know, to point out, you know, my Fat Guy Show, it's not about, we're not talking morals here, whether it's good to be fat or bad to be fat or anything about that. It's just kind of, we are fat. It exists. Fat, America gets fatter every year. We hear about and read about. And, it's always nice to see a fat guy doing well.
I appreciate that. To me, it's just about accepting who you are. This is what I am. I'm not going to try to hide this.
Right.
See it on TV in New York. And hey, I can't deny it. It is what I am, what I am at the moment.
No, so you are on TV a lot. You do two shows, on the SNY network, right? You do, Loudmouth with John every weekday at 6 p.m.
Right. With Adam Schein.
With Adam Schein.
NFL Radio. Yep.
Who has, let me tell you, a head of hair that's to die for. I mean, really, when I see him walk down the hall here, it's serious. I just want to run my fingers through it.
He uses too much product. You probably get it stuck.
And you do beer money? Do you still do beer money?
I don't do beer money anymore. I did that for a couple of years at the when we first started doing beer money. I did two seasons of it. And I also do the Mets pre- and post-game show.
Right.
Which is my primary gig with the Loud Mouse.
And I'm a graduate of Rutgers. You do the Rutgers basketball and football games. And so real quick, I'm going to assume, okay, let's start this. When did you first realize you were fat?
First of all, 6 foot 295.
Thank you. My bad. Bad host.
That's all right. I have fluttered between 280 and 320 for the majority of my adult life and just got back under 3. You know, when I first realized it, I mean, I was always a big kid.
Right.
You know, but, you know, you're 5, you're 6 years old, you get the fat jokes, it is what it is. But I was never huge, right? Got into high school. And somewhere between sophomore and junior years, like I went back and looked a couple of weeks ago at some old yearbooks, and there is no doubt that between sophomore and junior year, I put on a good 40 pounds.
Wow.
And that's where I looked at it and said, all right, that's when in high school when I knew I was fat. And then you get to college, and I put on, like, they talk about the freshman 15, like, no joke. I got during college all the way up to 347 pounds.
Oh, man.
347. And then, you know, it came down somewhat. I went to that the weight loss center at Duke.
Okay.
When I was a senior in college for like a month. So I got down like around 3. But when I first realized it, it was really, I don't know. It was really when I was probably in grade school.
And you're getting teased for it?
Yeah, absolutely getting teased.
So so you're putting on this weight in high school, you're getting bigger in college. When did you realize that you wanted to get a job in broadcasting And I don't know if TV was your first and foremost thought.
Okay. No, I never thought I was going into TV until a few years ago. Never.
Okay.
It was always radio. I went to Hobart and William Smith Colleges in upstate New York and got involved at the radio station there, started doing play by play, and thought, well, maybe I can make a career out of this. And so as soon as I graduated, I got an internship at WFAN here in New York. And from there, just got part-time, full-time, always wanted to do it, loved doing games. You know, they gave me shots on the air. And so, I got those chances. And as a result, it kind of builds and you get shows. And then I was doing the overnight show for a little while. I was, on the Ima show for a while, which was an unfortunate situation. but, you know, I was always just kind of like this guy that was admittedly fat guy. I tried to be just the normal guy you're going to have beers with and talk about sports. And right. that's what I was aiming for in radio. And it was working pretty well. And I mean, to go right into the TV thing, like 2006 is when SNY started. And they started having me on as a guest about different sports on Daily News Live and these different shows. And 2008, they said, all right, we want to start this show called Loudmouths. It's you and Adam Schein, who I knew. And, you know, this is going to be an everyday thing. I'm thinking, really? Like, at that point, I was a good 320.
Yeah, I was going to say, okay, so Loudmouth was actually one of the first things I knew you from.
Right.
So I didn't realize that was your first regular
first
TV gig.
First regular TV gig was really Loudmouth. And so, you know, I was like 320. And at this point, nobody is saying boo to me about my weight.
Right. So you're coming, when you're coming in to do your guest spots and everything, they're not panicking. It's not like find more makeup or douse the
sky. I mean, the makeup
something.
Thing was, yeah. You know, they have the guns. I mean, it's a good 15 minutes with the gun. I'm not exaggerating, especially because I'm bald.
The gun is what, powder?
Yeah. Well, but it's powder and it's also like, it's pure makeup. So it was a good 15 minute process until they honed it and got it down. But at any rate, so then at the end of that year, at the end of 2008, my contract was up at WFAN, and they said, we want to hire you full-time. And I'm like, are you have seen me, right? I mean, you know, 3-4 chins, the whole thing. I'm like, yeah.
That's great.
But the idea was, you know, they've got, you look, I never thought it was TV because you see all these guys who look perfect on TV, all these women, same thing. Well, and their thought process was, let's get the average guy on.
So you think your looks helped you? That you're saying?
Oh, there's no question.
Oh, it's interesting.
No question. So they were first time in my life.
They were pulling more. You're fat. The everyman is fat. Like we say on this show, 60% of Americans are overweight or obese. So this was working in your favor. Instead of putting a pretty boy up, we're going to put the every guy up.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I remember when we started doing Loudmouths and Brad Como from SNY got quoted, my boss got quoted in the paper as saying he looks like George the Animal Steel. Which I did, and I do, but the idea behind it was, hey, you know what? We've got these guys who look great on TV. We've got these guys, they all know sports. They're all very good. Let's get the guy who might identify a little bit more with the people watching. So I'm like, all right, that's fine. You know,
so
absolutely.
Do you think by being a big guy in high school and college that, don't worry about these microphones. I apologize. Okay. I don't know what equipment you're used to, but this is what we're used to. And nothing works. When you decided to go into broadcasting on the radio and you were already a big guy, do you think your weight played a part in that? Do you think if you were this, you know, Adam Schein looking type guy with a full head of hair, you might have gone at the TV route, or do you think your love was always with radio?
No, my love was always with radio.
Okay.
And I never, again, because of my looks, I never thought I was going to go into TV.
Right.
I thought it might be something you do as a guest spot or something like that. No, I thought it was my bread and butter was going to be radio. And then all of a sudden here this is, and you know, they like this persona of just a normal guy, had a little personality to me. And that's kind of what it became.
So now you know you're going to be on TV every night.
Right.
When you get the Loudmouth gigs, do you start panicking? Do you want to, about your style, about your dress or about your weight? Or are you just like, fuck it, this is what they wanted, so I'm just going to go in and be me?
You know what? I definitely felt like I'm going to go in and be me, but at the same time, you have to think about that stuff.
Right.
I mean, I'm not going to lie to you. A few years ago, I filled in on Channel 4 on a Giants preseason game. I did the play-by-play for a Giants preseason game.
I'm sure Mike Francesa's chair was just the right size for you. I don't think that was the problem.
No need to get on Mike.
Okay.
Mike has been a big help to me. But at any rate, I filled in on Channel 4, and I got home and I watched the tape, and I actually turned and said to my wife, how the hell did you let me get this fat? What happened? And, you know, yeah. So you start to think about it a little bit I, you know, like you'll see me at times kind of stick my head out to avoid the appearance of the 3 and 4 chins.
Oh, yeah, that's it. Actually, Benji showed me that move one time.
Yeah.
When I take his picture, he sticks his neck out. Like,
exactly.
Forward. And he said it makes everything look a little
skinnier. There's your fat guy tip.
There's a fat guy tip. And also, for people who don't live in the city, as a fat guy, I would imagine that this plays into it. You guys do one of those Today Show setups where not only are you a big guy on television, but now you're broadcasting to Sixth Avenue. You're down there in those glasses. I mean, you're like in a zoo, basically.
Yeah.
Do you ever think about that? Like, or are you just focused on the show?
I think more about the camera than I think about the people walking by. I mean, what am I going to do? I am not at the weight where you can hide any of it. And it's not, it just is what it is. So I'll do the best I can with it, but I'm thinking more about the camera and, you know, how bad it looks on the camera and that kind of thing.
Okay, we're going to take some phone calls, and then I want to get back to finding out more of Chris about Chris's life. You can follow Chris on Twitter, at ChrisCarlinSNY.com. I'm a little intimidated because you're such a professional broadcaster.
Oh, stop.
I used to listen to you on Rutgers. I heard you. Hold on a second. Mark in San Diego, what's your height? What's your weight?
5'8", 160.
Beautiful. What do you want to say to on Fat Guy Show?
Hey,
and by the way, you're not a fat guy, dude.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
We get so many skinny people on this show.
That's annoying.
Oh, come on, man.
Now, go ahead.
What's the official fat guy stance on light beer? I think it's faggy. I don't want to be around light beer.
All right. Well, Chris?
You know what? I don't have a problem with it. I'm a Coors Light guy or a Bud Light guy.
Right.
So, occasionally Corona, but light versus non-light... makes no difference to me whatsoever.
I enjoy the taste of a light beer.
Yeah.
But I'm not doing it for weight reasons. Are you drinking light beer?
No, absolutely not. I'm enjoying it because I like the taste. It doesn't matter about
so,
light beer.
So, Mark, I'm going to agree. I don't like your choice of words. But, yes, it's lame if you're drinking light beer to lose weight. But if you're drinking light beer because you like the taste, then, hey, why not? Chris in Long Island, give us your height. Give us your weight.
Hey, what's up, Jay? 6'2", 315.
There we go. Yeah. There we go. What can we do for you, fat sir?
5'8", 160, that last call.
Yeah, I know. It's embarrassing.
It's like those annoying people who have the little gut. Oh, I'm getting so fat. Shut up.
Out of here. What's your stance on footwear at your size? I mean, my footwear is all slip-on stuff.
You know what? I have switched to the slip-on stuff a lot more. You'll notice I'm wearing some dress shoes that are some slip-on. It's not. It's more out of the fact that, like, during Rutgers season and stuff, you travel a ton, and getting online at the airport, you slip it right off. It's not the pure
more,
laziness factor.
It's more the travel factor.
Exactly.
But that is, you know, fat guys do have to consider that it's harder for us to take off and put back on our shoes. So if you're taking them off at the airport, it's a whole to-do.
And really, I'm just trying to be considerate of everybody else.
Thank you.
I'm trying to move it along. You should thank me for getting my slip-on shoes.
I got a great tip on Twitter, and I apologize if I don't have the person's name in front of me, but they said that when you're a fat guy, make sure to tie your shoes, put on your shoes before you button your pants. And that is a great tip because if you have the big belly and you're trying and you buckle your pants and you try and lean over, lots of times if you can't reach your shoe, you feel your stomach fighting that button. So great, put on your pants, don't button them. Bend over, tie your shoes, and let's go from there. Speaking of clothes, have you? And I will share. I'm going to share first before I put you on the spot. Fat guy clothes moments, and I'm not. I've done a lot of talk about fashion on this show, but I'm going to talk about embarrassing fat guy clothes moments. And it happened to me here when I had just got hired on the show. I never told this story. I think Will reminded me of it a couple of weeks ago. I was wearing khakis. I bought a new pair of khakis, and they weren't fitting quite right, and I could feel that. And I bent over to get something, and bam, split. Right up the crotch. Oh. And I was panicked. I didn't know what to do. And I walked around all day with a staple gun, and I would just duck into the bathroom and just staple gun my crotch until my pants crotch until it popped back out again. But I walked around the Stern Show literally all day with just a gigantic hole in my crotch. And, so that's my embarrassing moment. Do you have any embarrassing?
I got a couple.
All right.
The one that immediately comes to mind though is I had some really good friends who got married about 10 years ago, 10, 12 years ago, and I was the best man. So I'm in the tux.
Okay.
And that's never a good scene to begin with because I'm renting the tux. So I have the ring. Priest calls for the rings. I drop the ring.
Oh.
Reach over to pick it up. There's the noise.
Oh. I know.
There was not. Now, the split didn't happen.
Okay. But the noise?
The noise was there. And it was like, and I kind of looked up. Let me tell you something. I have never moved quicker in my life to grab that ring and then come right back up. I mean, I was cat-like the way it was working. But I would say not the entire church heard it, but first two rows. First two rows, it definitely sounded like I split the pants.
Those tuxes are killer for a fat guy. When you're
and with the cummerbund too, it folds over. It's not a good.
And you know when you're with your boys and there's someone's getting married and everyone's drinking and having fun and then you get over to the tux shop and all of a sudden everyone's in and out and then they get to you.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh fuck, we got to pull out the one fat guy suit. God knows who wore that before us. Probably High Pitch Eric or something.
My issue with that is, man, you just try the best you can to get through that night.
Yes.
That's all there is to it.
And try and keep an extra pair of pants in the car if you can. That's what I'm going to try and do. We're going to go out to a break. When we come back, we're talking fat sports with Chris Carlin. Who are your favorite fat athletes? Who's the fattest athlete of all time that was actually good? Who got fat after they left sports? Fat coaches? Best sports for fat guys? We'll talk it all on The Fat Guys Show on Howard 101.
Yes, go have that snack. We'll be right fat.
There's more to come. Call 888-STERN-101.
The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan
on Howard 101.
Back to the fat. It's the Fat Guy Show.
Watch out, fat boy.
Oh my God, he's huge.
He makes sumo wrestlers look healthy.
We're back with the Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan on Howard 101.
Call 888-STERN-101.
Welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. I am your fat host, Jason Kaplan, and the Fat Guy Show is brought to you by King Size, the big and tall experts. Visit KingSizeDirect.com. Joining me tonight is Chris Carlin. He's from the SNY Network. He does the Mets pre- and post-game shows. He hosts Loudmouths every night at 6 p.m. You can follow him on Twitter, at Chris Carlin, SNY. I'm at Sirius J, and everyone always says, what's going to happen if you ever leave Sirius? I'm like, I don't know. I'll change my fucking name on Twitter. How hard is it?
Not very complicated.
Yeah, right? Let me tell you something. I could very easily see at Chris Carlin ESPN. I could see that happening.
Let's not get nuts.
I have friends over there.
Let's not get nuts.
Listen, those guys lose their jobs like crazy over there. They can't keep their hands to themselves, from what I understand. They used to call you the Continent.
Yeah.
Is this true?
It's very true.
Who gave you that nickname?
Mike. Did.
Mike? Yeah. Fuck you, Mike.
Well, that's cool. No, you know what it was, though? If you remember, it was probably, I was producing Mike and the Mad Dog.
Mike Francesa?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Mike Francesa, yeah.
He's got a lot of nerve.
You know, it was about, 15 years ago or so. I was producing Mike and the Mad Dog, and if you remember, the guy who played for Oklahoma State named Big Country Bryant Reeves, he was a, you know, big basketball player. The next year, there was a guy who was 7'3", 350, who played for St. Mary's, and they called him Big Continent. And so that's like, it was right around the tournament
time. That's cool.
And that's how I got it.
And you became the Continent?
Exactly.
By the way, Mike's looking good. I have to say, Mike was a big fat guy, Mike Francesa, but he's,
No, Mike's lost some weight.
He's lost some weight. Yeah. That's good for him. I love both those guys. And, you know, we have, Chris Russo here now. And I know we're talking very local sports radio here, but man, I loved when Mike and the Mad Dog were together. And
they're great.
They're both good separately. Guys, we're talking fat sports. I want you guys calling in 888-STERN-101. That's 888-783-7610 to talk about some of your favorite fat athletes, your favorite fat coaches, your favorite fat sports. Great places to see games for fat guys. But let's just hit the phones real quick. Larry in Ohio, give me your height, give me your weight.
What's up, guys? Jason, I'm your biggest fan. I'm 6'4".
Yeah.
And I'm 430 pounds.
Nicely done, sir. You are my biggest fan.
Godspeed, son.
But it's not all fat. I got a lot of muscle under there.
All right, good. Whatever you got to do to get you through, bro. Do you have a question or are you just,
I've heard your show on before and I never got a chance to listen to it. And I'm listening today and I'm hooked. I'm a fan. I'm not really into the sports thing, but you guys were talking about your embarrassing moments. I normally wear like a tank top with a t-shirt on over top of it, and I had that happen to me one time, so I just took the t-shirt off and used it like a skirt in the back and covered the back.
So you walked around with a tank top and then a t-shirt tied around your back to cover a rip in your pants?
Pretty much. In order to get me home, it's what I had to do, brother.
You know what, dude? You win the Fat Guy Show today. I don't have a prize, but you win. You're the man. Thank you for listening and thank you for sharing. All right. So fat sports. I've been excited knowing that you were coming in because I love sports. I love watching baseball and football and basketball. And one of the things I love about sports is that not only is there for fat guys to watch athletic guys play, but there are a lot of big guys in sports.
Yeah.
And successful big guys in sports.
Absolutely. And I'm not even counting the NFL.
Right.
Because to me, that's just a whole nother entity. Okay.
Okay.
I don't count linemen.
Yeah.
But like you go into baseball and you got a guy like Prince Fielder.
Yes.
Who is 275, 280 pounds and hitting the snot out of the baseball.
And by the way, a legacy fat guy.
Exactly. Legacy. I read somewhere today when I was researching for tonight that Cecil Fielder was 235 at one point. He was never 235 pounds.
No way. That might have been his batting average.
Yeah, exactly. He was never under 300 pounds.
Yeah, I was going to say. And okay, so let's talk baseball. We'll get to football in a second because I think, to me, obviously, football's the fattest, friendliest.
Right.
Because and even taking offensive linemen off the table. I mean, all right, with the exception of the receiver.
Well, here's the problem for me with football. Even if you're a huge guy, you have to work out.
Yes.
You have to have muscle.
Right.
You have to be able to move people. There are not guys who are just pure fat and can't, you know, and don't lift or anything like that.
Well, you can't just stand there and have people run into you.
But I don't know about you. When I was a kid, it always ticked me off. Here's another time where I knew I was fat.
Right.
Sixth, seventh grade, I'm playing PAL football. And I was not allowed to ever be in a position where you could handle the football because they had a weight rule. You had to be under 135 pounds to be a running back, quarterback, or wide receiver.
Now, this is a rule your coach made up?
No, this was a rule in the league.
Oh, wow.
It was, and then, you know, it's pretty common.
Oh.
So I was never under 135 pounds at that point. So I could never handle the football. But then there was a guy a few years ago who broke the fat ceiling, if you will. Jared Lorenzen, remember him?
Jared Lorenzen is on my sheet. He is the back, one of the backup quarterbacks on the Giants.
Yes.
He's a big boy. Go look him up, everybody.
He set all kinds of records at Kentucky.
Yes.
He was 6'3", 300 pounds.
Yes.
They called him the round mound of touchdown, you know, you name it. And this guy was very good, but he's the only really fat guy that was in like the skill position in the NFL.
So it's almost like communism in a way where you couldn't have tried to do a different position if you wanted to. That they looked at you and they said, look, you're a lineman or you're a defensive back and that's it and end of story.
I never played anything other than offensive guard or tackle and defensive line.
Wow.
It drove me nuts.
Well, and that was me too. I mean, I wasn't a great athlete, but when I did play, it was offensive line or defensive tackle.
Yeah.
That'd be same deal. I would take that. So, okay. So football players were going to take off the table because they're pretty much all fat.
Right.
Okay. But again, if we're talking fat friendly sports, fat guys, this is a way for you to be athletic. I mean, yes, like Chris said, you have to work out. You can't be lazy and fat and play football. But if you're a big guy, if you're genetically predisposed to be a big guy, or you just are a big guy and are looking for a way to fit in or get more exercise. I mean, I can't think of a more fat friendly sport, you know, of the mainstream sports than football.
I agree with that. I agree with that. But you can be out of shape and play baseball.
Okay, now let's get to that.
Now look at CC Sabathia.
Let's talk CC.
I read the other day, he's like, yeah, I'm down, man. I'm feeling great. I'm 289. First of all, I don't buy that he's 289. And secondly, you know what? The guy's had an unbelievable career. David Wells. David Wells pitched at 300 pounds.
My hero. I love David Wells. David Wells was fat. And yeah, you're right. It wasn't even an in-shape fat. He was sweating and huffing and puffing before he threw the first pitch.
I'll tell you a great David Wells story that I saw one time. If this doesn't sum up David Wells, I don't know what does. Super Bowl in 2000, I was in Atlanta, and I saw David Wells at the hotel, and he's there with a buddy. They're both drinking a beer. Police officer walks over and says, excuse me, sir, you can't have the beer, open container laws. He's like, okay. They both walk over, place the beers in a garbage can. Officer walks away, go back, grab it, start drinking again.
Hey, man, waste not, want not.
That is outstanding.
How about Mo Vaughn? You remember Mo Vaughn?
Oh, yeah. How do you forget Mo Vaughn?
He was fat, and then he signed a fat contract, and then he got triple the size.
Yeah.
I mean, that is just it. So we're in the baseball realm here. Is it the uniform? Is it the uniform that's just unflattering?
So. I don't even think it's unflattering, though. Look at CC.
Right.
Look at Prince Fielder. Look at Wells. They all wore the huge uniform so that it would kind of be a little bit baggy on him. And it did not look like, you'd look at him and you'd think, I could see it. What does he weigh, like 250? No. Those guys are huge. Those guys are huge.
And going back to CC, he said that he knew he was about 10 pounds overweight last year when he got a little winded in July. I'm like,
Like, dude, just look in the mirror, man.
That he would, God bless him, but he admitted, like, yeah, for breakfast, I'd usually have a box of Captain Crunch. A box of Captain Crunch.
One of my all-time, we're going to stay in baseball then for a while. One of my all-time favorites, and Matt Berry from ESPN hit me up to make sure I hit him. Mm. He likes to call him Big Fat Bartolo Colon. Big Fat Bartolo Colon.
Yeah.
Used to pitch on the Yankees last year and actually didn't do too bad. But this is a guy who every year has gotten heavier and heavier and heavier, and yet somehow can succeed.
And he continues to pitch well. And he continues to throw the ball 90 miles an hour. I haven't looked and see how he's doing in Oakland now, but he's still huge.
And then, of course, there's some Hall of Famers like Tony Gwynn and Kirby Puckett.
Tony Gwynn is huge now. I mean, listen, he was big when he was playing. Tony Gwynn now is huge.
Would you say over 350?
Yeah, I think he's around 300 pounds.
Wow.
And he's had some health issues, too,
and
around that. But Tony Gwynn is very big.
Tony, go swing a bat, my man. Yeah, Kirby Puckett got huge.
Yeah.
I mean, he was chunky as a player and then got huge. Mm-hmm. By the way, Richard Deitch from Sports Illustrated, all the sports guys are chiming in with their big, fat players. I got this, and I don't know who this is, so maybe you could explain it to me. And I'm a sports novice. I apologize. Rod Beck.
Rod Beck, yeah. He was a reliever for the Giants for the Cubs for a long time. Big fat guy, had the mullet, had the full mustache. When he was in the minors trying to make a comeback, lived in a trailer out behind the ballpark in Iowa. And, you know, this guy would knock back beers left and right. Now, had some other issues. Unfortunately, died because of an overdose. But that was a guy that you would look at and you'd be like, yeah, that guy is a guy I want to hang out with.
That's all. And Brian on Twitter, Texas Forever 74, wrote, Rod Beck was once asked about coming into spring training overweight. His answer, you can't pull fat.
That's an excellent point.
Which I love. So baseball, before we get, because I want to get back on the coaches, or I want to get over the coaches for a second, but no, I want to talk about basketball. Basketball's a sport that I love. And mm-hmm. There aren't that many fat basketball players. It's almost impossible because you have to run up and down the court. But being a Knicks fan, we're lucky. We found one of the fat guys a few years ago, Eddie Curry.
Yeah.
Which, again, you know, I love to support fat people everywhere, but not on the basketball court. Fat people work on the baseball field for me. They work on football, obviously. You see a fat guy, especially when they're not playing well in basketball, I'm just angry.
You get ticked off.
Yeah. Fat guys aren't meant to run like that.
Eddie Curry is lazy.
Yeah.
He was always lazy as a Knick. He really was. And you just think he's been a lazy player throughout his career because he's always been 300 pounds. And look, I can appreciate laziness like anybody, but I get what you're saying. Eddie Curry never did anything for the Knicks.
Oh, that's where even fat guys start hating other fat guys. Cause you just look at me and go, you fat, lazy piece of shit. Just get the fuck up. And
I mean, put it this way. There was very little appreciation for watching Eddie Curry play when he did play. Sean Kemp got pretty fat too.
Yeah. Towards the end.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. He got pretty fat toward the end.
All right. How about one of, favorite fat players who has gotten so much fatter on air, and he has an on-air job like you, one Mr. John Kruk.
Yeah, he's gotten pretty big. He was pretty big. He was pretty big when he played. I see that. He could hit. But again, like, you know, I wanted to see John Kruk have a longer career, and he probably didn't because he was fat. But,
yeah.
You know.
Well, maybe the cancer.
I forgot about that.
Yeah,
that's a good point, too. But he...
Right. If he was in better shape, maybe his body wouldn't have broken
absolutely.
Down. Absolutely. John Daly. It's another one of my all-time
favorites.
John Daly,
I read somewhere today that he's, like, now 190 pounds. I mean, come on.
Dude. It'll last a month. I mean, come
John,
on.
How do you not appreciate John Daly, a guy that on the golf course during a major or during any tournament will be out there smoking a butt and has a beer in his hand?
I love it. And just some real quick ones I got off Twitter today that we haven't mentioned. The Fridge, of course, Refrigerator Perry, Albert Haynesworth, George Foreman.
George Foreman winning the heavyweight championship when he was
huge.
Fat. I mean, remember when George Foreman won at like 47 and he had his shorts pulled up? Like right underneath his nipples. That's how far up it was. And that was a great moment for fat guys everywhere. I was in college for that.
And I'm not joking. George Foreman has a legacy of fat. There's probably about 25 pounds on me right now that were just solely from hamburgers I made in college on the George Foreman grill. The man gave me the ability to cook indoors, and I love him.
Yeah, I love him. But don't you find that ironic that, like, it drills out the fat of the burger and it's George Foreman's grill?
Yeah.
I mean, that always bothered me.
Well, see, at the time, they're always trying to pump it as a health thing because the fat drips out. All I saw was you can make hamburgers inside. Like, that's all I saw.
Fair point. I'm not gonna lie, I had one too.
Okay, but now I want to get to and really quick, athletes that got fat afterwards, I have to mention Charles Barkley. I like Charles Barkley, but wow, damn, dude. You know, because he's such a moralizer and he likes to sit on his high throne and kind of tell people what's what. But
you know what? Charles Barkley is a guy that never makes bones about who he is.
That's true.
And doesn't care what anybody else thinks. And look, I don't agree with everything he says. He says a lot of stupid things, but I respect the fact that Charles Barkley doesn't try to hide what he is at all.
Arm in Long Island, what's your height? What's your weight?
I'm 5'11". I'm 180 pounds, but on the basketball court, I'm 6'8", 325. I am a chubby chaser. I have a fetish for big, fat NBA players who play way more agile than they look. There was a guy who played for the Washington Bullets by the name of John Hot Plate Williams at LSU. He would get a defensive rebound, elude a point guard, an off guard, a small forward going for a steal, put it behind his back, through his legs, and then chuck out this no-look pass to Bernard King or Jeff Malone for a layup. I've never seen anyone move. He would just go up and up and up. Like, he literally gained 10 pounds like every 15 games. But black guys have this thing. Like, you guys just focus on black guys look better, fat. Like,
what?
I hate
We're going to bring race into this?
He was like, I loved Stanley Roberts, who was an older son. He was Shaquille O'Neal's flank on LSU. He got in the NBA, and I loved him. I didn't care how fat he got. There's something charismatic about big, fat, black NBA player. Oliver Miller. Oliver Miller was, what, 6'9", 340. Loved watching him play. Loved watching him as agile as he could be.
Okay. Thanks. All right, I had to cut you off at some point.
Well, when it comes to race, I don't look at. When it comes to fat, I don't look at race.
Yeah, thank you.
I mean, come on. Yes. Fat is fat. It doesn't matter what you are.
Fat cuts across every race, every creed, every color.
We build bridges. Group. That's what we do.
Cody in Arkansas, give us your height, give us your weight.
6'3".
Nice. Good job, man.
I got two excellent tips that I've never heard because I just do it myself. Mm-hmm. For guys who work in a professional environment, for undershirts, big guys have a huge problem of bending over and showing some crack or something like that.
Yep.
For undershirts, you can go get tall tees from like Champs or some type of sports store.
King size direct.
Yeah, all king size direct. Tuck them in, and even if your overshirt, your button up's a little too short, you got the tall tee, you can bend over and not have to worry about crack.
That's a good tip, my man. Oh, I'm gonna move on. I know you had a second one, but I wanted to do more fat sports. Matt in Staten Island, what's your height? What's your weight?
6'2", 240. What's up, the guys?
What's up?
All right.
You're doing a great job, guys.
Thanks.
I wanted to say that I played college baseball, and I played with a kid by the name of Frank Beckhorn, and, you know, if you call him Fat Frank, he was about, you know, 290, 6 foot. And this kid, as fat as he was, to this day, 10 years later, he still holds the Division I, Division II, and Division III. NCAA batting average, slugging percentage, RBIs, you know, so I played with a lot of guys that were fat, that were agile, and were fast, and, you know, so I don't even know.
See, we're athletic, ladies, fat guys, might hold state championship records. Nothing turns a girl on more than a local high school state champion record, right?
Like Al Bundy.
Hey, Mike in Maine, what's your height, what's your weight?
Hey, Jason, what's up, man? I'm 6 feet, probably 205.
You're svelte.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, I've normally been better shape this time of year.
Stop bragging. Get to your question.
Now I'm in sales, so I'm chubbier. Anyway, so Kevin Duckworth got in trouble with the Blazers, if I remember correctly, back in the day when he was finishing up his career because he was overweight.
Who was that?
Kevin Duckworth, who was
Kevin
a center
Duckworth,
for the Blazers.
Remember him?
Yeah.
He was a center and he was fat?
You wouldn't look at him and think he was unbelievably fat. I think they got on him because they felt like he was out of shape.
Okay.
But I never looked at Kevin Duckworth and thought he was unbelievably fat.
You know, my brother just texted me Shaquille. Now, that's one of those guys that kept popping up on these lists I was looking at. That to me, Shaquille doesn't look fat. He's just a big guy.
Yeah.
That has put on some weight since he retired, but I don't know if I call him fat.
I wouldn't call him fat yet, especially when you're 7'2". You got a long way to go.
Right.
I mean, Shaq was 300 pounds when he played just out of natural.
You can't do weight on Shaq.
No.
It's look.
For Shaq to be fat, he would have to be like 370.
So let's talk, because we're running out of time, and I got to get to really my favorite topic about fat sports, which are the coaches.
Yeah.
The coaches crack me up, because, and maybe you're way more into the sports world than I am. When I see a Rex Ryan, when I see a Bill Parcells yelling at these, for the most part, great athletes, you know, it always makes me wonder, is there a disconnect between an athletic sports player and their big fat coach yelling at them? I'm sure, you know, they're going to say, like, oh, we respect everything and all that good stuff. But why are coaches fat, and can fat coaches be effective?
Because coaches don't have to be in shape.
Okay.
Now, if you'll notice, like, there is a trend now outside of Rex, where coaches are in unbelievable shape, because especially in the NFL right. and in college, because the hours that they put in, they can't afford to be fat because they're going to have no energy at all. But a guy like Rex, I don't buy that there's a disconnect with them, because if they identify with the players, that's ultimately all that's going to matter. It doesn't matter physically. It's if they appreciate what they're going through. But Rex, I mean, you know, Rex is over 3 easily before.
Oh yeah.
So supposedly recently he lost like 90 pounds.
What?
But he won't talk about how he lost it.
Well, it's like Star Jones did
during
that.
This offseason, which made me think, I mean, we know that he had the lap band before. Yep. Did he get the, you know, the, what do you call it? The,
hey, sexy, he got a liposuction.
Liposuction.
Sexy yeah. Rexy, all the Jets fans want you to do is win. You don't have to worry about how you look. Just don't die on the sideline and win. And actually, and his brother Rob Ryan has been on the record as saying that he thinks his weight is keeping him from getting jobs because he looks so unhealthy.
Well, there were other guys that felt the same way. Charlie Weiss thought the same thing for a long time.
Big fat guy.
Yeah.
Big fat guy.
And he did the lap band, and he had complications from the lap band.
Jesus.
So. You know what?
But, you know,
you're trying to get healthier. It doesn't always get healthier.
Yeah, right? I mean, Weiss, I mean, and this is a guy that, if you guys don't know who Charlie Weiss is, look him up. He was a Patriots coach, and then he was the head coach of Notre Dame, and then I think he ended up at Kansas City. But this is a guy that I'm not 100% sure can walk up and down the sideline.
Well, he's got, because he had that issue with the surgery, but at the same time, he's huge.
Huge!
He is a big, big dude.
Now, one coach in particular whose weight never seems to have held him back from a job, who is probably my favorite fat guy in all sports of all time, Andy Reid.
Yeah.
Andy Reid, to me, is the king of fat guys in sports. Lots of reasons here. First of all, he looks like a nerd. Forget the fat for a second. He looks like a nerd, and yet he's the head coach of, like, you know, the most rough and tumble Big East, you know, football team that there is.
Well, what's the first thing that they tell us as fat guys when you're getting dressed? Wear dark colors, right? Because it's supposedly slimming. If you see Andy Reid, when you get into like November and December, he will put on this Eagles snowsuit that is all black. There is nothing slimming about it. It's like a giant one piece that would be a zip up. And God bless him. He's got to be 350, and he looks every bit of it.
Andy looks like he looks like one of those fat guys that's never not been fat. Like, he was just born a plump, red baby. For some reason, I know this is gross, but for some reason, he looks like one of those guys whose underwear is just always dirty. Like, there's just nothing you can do about
that.
I know, but I can't. He's got that look about him. And I've heard from people in the Philadelphia area, because I have a lot of friends down there, that says he's not even shy about eating. He'll be out shoveling plates of pasta down his throat and sandwiches and steaks and... I got to tell you, this is the fact. I saw him 10 years ago. I was living with Will, and he was a huge Eagles fan. I'm like, this guy, if he's alive 3 years from now, I'll be shocked. And not only is he alive, but he's alive. He's still a head coach. He's a winning head coach. I think Andy Reid is one of the most successful fat guys that I love in all sports.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I think that's fair. He's won a lot. But I mean, I am shocked that he has never had any health issue.
Yeah.
I am shocked, because you're right. He has always been fat, at least from what I can remember seeing.
Never seen a skinny picture of him.
No, absolutely not. Oh, God bless him.
What can you tell me? I just got hit up on this with Twitter about Mark Mangino from the Jayhawks.
Oh,
should I be the king?
The king. He got fired last year, but Mark Mangino was easily 450.
Wow.
Had to be.
I'm gonna, you keep talking.
You Google image him. Yeah. Mark Mangino. If you don't know who Mark Mangino is, he is our king. He is absolutely our king.
Mangino. Mark Mangino. Listen, we gotta go to a break, unfortunately. But, holy shit. He is huge.
I told you.
He is huge.
I told you.
Guys, during the break, do me a favor. Go Google Mark Mangino. He might take the place of, Andy Reid for me. In terms of fat coaches,
he is two Andy Reids.
That is an apt description.
And about 5 inches shorter.
It's like if two Andy Reids just ran into each other really fast and just the Jayhawks coach. Guys, stay through the break. I got a special guest calling in. 888 Stern 101. We'll be right back on the Fat Guy Show.
We're always on the bottom.
Oh, yeah.
We'll be right back.
Call 888 Stern 101.
The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan
on Howard 101.
Back to the Fat Guy Show. It tastes like chicken. The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan
on Howard 101.
Call 888 Stern 101.
Now, here's Jason Kaplan.
Hey, Welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. Oh, talking over my tuba. Somebody just hit me up on Twitter saying that they could tell them this isn't a real tuba, and they were offering to record real tuba to tape for me, and I think I'm going to take them up on that. Welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. We're on Howard 101. You call in 888-STERN-101. I'm sitting here with Chris Carlin, the host of Loudmouths on the SNY Network every weeknight at 6 p.m., and also he hosts the pre- and post-game for the Mets games on SNY. To all you Mets fans out there, when you're sitting on the edge of your seat after a thrilling Mets victory, Chris is there to cheer with you. Andrew in Richmond, give me your height, give me your weight.
6'2", 320.
That's what I like to hear. Yeah. That's a fat guy. You know what Howard always says? We have a girl on the show, and she's like 5'7", 105 pounds, and he goes, that's the weight you should be? This is the weight of my callers right now. What are you, 6'1", 320? Is that what you said?
Yep.
Yeah. 6'2", 320? That's the official fat guy height and weight, all right? Congratulations,
I'm
Andrew.
Wearing that compliment as a badge of honor.
All right, well, what was your question for us?
Hey, I just want to weigh in quickly before that on the athlete. You know why George Foreman wears his tights so far up, right?
Hmm.
Have you ever tried to tie a rope around a basketball?
Oh, man. I'm almost going to take everything away I gave you. I'm going to take it back. for your question.
My athlete was Andre the Giant. At one point in one meal, he had 118 beers, 16 steaks, and 12 lobsters.
That sounds good to me. I picked you up because I thought you had a question about stadiums. So I'll just ask Chris myself. Chris, you've been to baseball stadiums, football stadiums, basketball stadiums. Where are the most fat-friendly places to go see a game?
City Field's actually pretty good.
Right.
The new seats at Citi Field are nice and wide, and they've got the cup holders in front of you, and you've got leg room too. That's the other part of the underrated part of the fat guy experience at the ballpark. When you're too squeezed in, it really makes you too, you know, just completely uncomfortable. Went to a game at the World Series last year with my brother Steve, 6'6", 270.
All right.
Roughly.
Big guy.
Him and me sitting next to each other at a stadium was not a good scene. I was about 290 at the time too, and trying to sit next to each other. I mean, you can't do that. You need a little more room. I find that a lot of the newer stadiums are helping you out with a little bit more room.
A little bit more room?
Exactly.
I love that. And also the new stadiums are really putting a premium on food.
Yes.
I mean, Citi Field, I mean, that half the press release about the new stadium was food.
And by the way, we should correct. There is the one area now, the Party City Deck. Since
yes.
They moved in the fences at Citi Field, they have this new Party City Deck and left, where I think it's a group thing, but it's all you can eat and all you can drink.
Well, Chris, we might have to do a show from there because that's exciting. If there was ever a reason to go to a Mets game, that would be the one.
Shake Shack, come on, man.
Oh, Shake Shack and Yankees have Lobel's in there and Johnny Rockets, and it's just great food at ball games. All right, Denise in Delaware, give us your height. Well, you're a woman. All right, yeah, give us your height, give us your weight. Oh, well, there you go. All right, goodbye. That was successful. She waited on hold for 45 minutes. Sorry, Denise. On the hotline right now, I just wanted to take with the last 5 minutes of this show to say hello and happy Father's Day to the original fat guy, my dad, Howie Kaplan. What's up, Dad?
Hey, Jay. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm good.
What's your height? What's your weight?
My height is about 6 feet, and my weight is more than you.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Now, in all fairness, to be completely up and on. To be completely honest with the audience, my dad has had one of those lap band surgeries. What you have? Which one did you have?
I had the full-out gastric bypass.
Yeah, the gastric bypass. What was that, about 15 years ago?
About 1995, I think.
Now, where were you at your biggest? You were over 400,
right?
466. 466, and is that when you went and did the lap band surgery?
Yeah. Yes.
And so you're not anywhere near 466
now? No.
What are you down to now?
About 330.
Hey, you look great.
Yeah. I should probably be about 280, but, you know.
Well, I wanted to, first of all, wish you a happy Fat Father's Day.
Oh, thank you.
I wanted to sarcastically thank you for passing the fat gene on to me. because I didn't start putting on big weight until college. Did you look at me and my brothers and think, wow, maybe it's going to skip them? Maybe because you and your sister, quite frankly, are big.
Yeah,
your mom was big. I never met your dad, unfortunately, but yeah. I'm assuming he was big.
Yeah, it kind of runs in the family. Well, you know, you were in high school. You were fairly svelte.
Right.
You played football, and you know, I don't even remember when you started to get heavy. To tell you the truth, I guess it was.
But so were you? Look, I know if I had a kid right now, I'd be staring, waiting for his back hair to appear, waiting for the gut to come out over the pants. Like, were you? Or do you just didn't give a shit?
No, it's not that I didn't give a shit. It's just, you know, you don't think about those things all the time.
I do.
You know, I know you've often said, you know, thank us for the gene pool that we've given you. But, you know, it's just luck of the draw. What can I tell you?
All right, then I'm going to fire some questions at you because we're running out of time here. Have you always been fat, or do you remember the first time you realized you were fat?
I think I was always the biggest kid in school. I mean, and I'm a hair over 6 feet. I've been a hair over 6 feet since sixth grade. I mean, I was not only fat, I was also tall for, you know, I was much taller than everybody, but, you know, pretty much I was 9 pounds when I was born.
All right, so you're always, you don't know life as a skinny guy is what you're saying.
No, not at all.
Do you wish you did, or have you come to grips with everything?
You know, there was one period in time before I had the gastric bypass, I don't know if you remember this, but I'd gone on the liquid protein diet and I lost a whole bunch of weight.
OptiFast, it looked miserable.
Yeah, the OptiFast, and that was probably
Chris is shaking his head, were you on OptiFast?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
OptiFast, I learned how to make OptiFast brownies, OptiFast. Milkshakes. I was doing everything.
OptiFast. Hold on a second. That OptiFast is this. It was the diet that where you take a shake instead of eating. Right?
Yeah. You
ate no solid food. But I lost 140 pounds in 9 months.
And then what?
And then I gained back 190 pounds.
Yeah. I lost 9 pounds in 2 weeks and quit.
Yeah. So you know, it's like once you start eating solid food, forget about it.
Do you remember? Well, actually, hold on. I'll hold that for a second. So Chris and I were talking about sports stadiums and where's a friendly place for fat guys to go. Like, you have brought me to a few Yankee games over the last recent years.
Right.
And I don't know if you're cheap or what, but you keep buying bleacher tickets. And bleachers are not fat friendly. First of all, you look like you're going to die halfway through the game. It's depressing.
I wasn't because we were cheap. That's what we wanted to do. Is to experience. That 1 year we bought one of those season things, and it happened to be bleacher seats. But
Yankee Stadium, at least the old one. I haven't sat in the bleachers to the new one, but the old Yankee Stadium. I mean, if you went in an afternoon game, Chris, I don't know if you've been in the bleachers out there, but the sun just beats down on you.
Yeah, it's not a good scene.
But Jason, I remember. I mean, you took us to a Yankee game when the new stadium opened, and you got us in the nice, comfortable seats.
Yeah, well, you know, I have a nice, high profile job now.
Right.
Do you remember when I turned to you when I was probably about 4 or 5 years old and asked you why you were so fat?
No, honestly, no.
I do, because you got so sad. My dad, I was sitting there. I'll never forget this. I was about 4 or 5 years old. I was sitting on his bed, and he was changing to go to work, and he took his shirt off. And just in one of those kid ways where you don't realize what you're saying is being a douchebag. I'm like, hey, why are you so fat? What's up with that?
I've gotten it from nieces and nephews.
Have you?
Oh, absolutely.
They just, right, they're just...
Absolutely. It's just, why are you fat?
I don't remember that. But I was in a store last week, and I was looking for someone, and there's a little kid there with his father, and the kid looks at me and goes, you're fatter than my daddy.
That's lovely. So complete stranger.
Yeah, complete stranger.
Speaking of, I love mom, and she used to be skinny and all that, but she's older now.
You know, she is listening.
Mom, don't take offense, but you've always been the fat one in the family, right?
Me? Yeah.
No, in our family. I'm talking our nucleus. Me, my brothers, you and mom.
Yeah.
You're the fat guy.
Absolutely.
Right, okay. At some point, your spouse, I'll talk about her in the third person here, started to possibly eclipse you, or at least you were coming down and she was coming up. Has that happened in your opinion, even though she's sitting right next to you?
She's not sitting next to me, but I don't know. It just happens.
Does that bother you?
Stress? Does it bother me? Yeah, it bothers me. I mean, it bothers me that I haven't been able to lose as much weight as I'd like, but, you know.
Well, I love you both, and I don't care how fat you get. Happy Father's Day. Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you.
And I'll just get my kids a diet book, I guess. You were no help. You were no help. Thank you, Dad.
All right. Love you.
Hey, Scotty, for real. Now, there's a skinny sports guy. Chris, we're coming to an end here.
Yeah.
But summer is right around the corner. And you and I know sweat is our enemy.
Yeah. Heat is not our friend.
Do you have any tips for
I got a couple
cool?
of quick ones. Let's all right. Number one. You can be the fat guy. You can even be the fat, sweaty guy. You cannot be the fat and smelly guy. All right?
Right.
You cannot do it. So when you are taking showers, the best way to go about it, cool the shower down.
Ooh, good one.
Cool the shower down. It will last. It will help.
Because you can actually sweat in the shower.
Absolutely, you can. And you will sweat after the fact because of a hot shower.
Good, great tip.
Secondly, if you're a guy that's got to wear business clothing every day, white shirt. And here's why.
Why?
Because if you wear a darker shirt, and you're going to sweat through when you're walking in the street, people are going to see it. You're wearing the white shirt, might not see it as much. I'm always embarrassed when I got the back sweat.
Yes.
White shirt, they don't see it.
That's an excellent tip. And by the way,
I can't stress the smell thing enough. Take cool showers and take multiple, whatever number of showers you need to take a day, take it.
Baby powder is your friend.
Baby powder is your friend. And just try and stay, for me, just try and stay near an AC at all time. Movie theaters are great.
Yep.
Here in the city, we're very lucky to have one right around the corner. And stay out of the subways. They are killer. Oh. They are killer. Guys, unfortunately, we run out of time. And by guys, I mean my audience listening. Chris Carlin, thank you so, so much. I'm so psyched you came up
here. I was thrilled to be here. Thanks for having
me. Awesome. You can follow Chris on Twitter at ChrisCarlinSNY and find all his great stuff on the SNY Network. It's the Fat Guy Show only on Howard 101. And very big thank you to King Size Direct, the big and tall experts. Visit KingSizeDirect.com. Thank you for not going home, Jimmy. Have a great night. Happy Fat Day.
You know they can never be whack. The fat boys are back. Howard 101. In a country where the obese outnumber the skinny, who's looking out for the big guy?
Who is willing to sit down and say, I'm not too big, this doorway is too small? When you need someone to say, we're fat, we're here, and we're going to get extra mayo on that. He's large, he's in charge, and he's full of advice. Your fat host.
What is up, Fat America? I am your fat host, Jason Kaplan. And it is summertime, fat people. And if you're fat like me, you know this is not a fun time of year to be a fat guy. First of all, everyone takes their shirt off, which is bullshit. I don't understand how that is just okay with everybody. You know, going to pool parties, going to the beach, just playing or walking down the street. You see people with their shirt off, and none of us feel comfortable doing that. But we also have to beat the heat, and the heat kills us in a million different ways. First and foremost, sweating everywhere, stickiness, disgustingness, feeling like you're going to die. I was outdoors this weekend at a friend's house, and this really fat kid, fatter. If I say someone's really fat, that just means they're fatter than me. That's what I mean to say. This really fat kid actually said at one point, why is my stomach sweating? And I said, this is just the way it goes in the summer. I just got handed a note from the producer. Always remember to wear a double t-shirt. That'll be producer Jim McClure, of course. Always remember to wear a double T. It makes you sweat more, but it also hides the sweat better from you. Anyway, welcome to the show. It's Fat Summer, and we are going to be doing an ode to the fat guy's best friend at summertime. I'll play a little of that ode to the air conditioning. I know we're a little bit early.
The Fat Guy Show, ode to the air conditioner.
Oh. You can't just stick your head near the radio. It still feels good. Just the sound feels good. It is the air conditioner, the single greatest invention in mankind history, and I have facts to back me up on that. Thanks to Rob, the intern, for compiling those for me. I have facts to prove that the air conditioner is one of the most important inventions in the 21st century, the 20th century of any century. So we'll be talking a lot about the air conditioner. Please call in to the show 888-STERN-101 to talk about the air conditioner, to talk about what it means to you, any air conditioning stories you have. Have you ever been stuck without air conditioner? Have you ever known someone who wouldn't use air conditioning? I've known a few of these people. They're crazy. So call in 888-STERN-101. That's 888-783-7610. We'll be talking air conditioner. We'll be talking ways to stay cool. We'll be talking to, later in the show, the meat magician, Pat LaFrieda. You might know him from the Food Network show, Meat Men. He'll be calling in later to talk about barbecues and some fat innovations you might not be aware of. But first, let me get to a little fat news before we get to any of this.
Watch out, fat boy! Fat news of the world. Spanning the globe from love handle to love handle.
I am now going to play you a clip from Don Thompson of McDonald's. Al, have the music ready. This is a great announcement made a few weeks ago.
We're pleased to announce that McDonald's is renewing its commitment as a worldwide top sponsor and the official restaurant of the Olympic Games through the year 2020. Now that includes the 2014 Winter Games in Sochi, the 2016 Summer Games in Rio de Janeiro, the 2018 Winter Games in Pyeongchang, and the 2020 Summer Games.
That is, of course, Don Thompson from McDonald's. Ladies and gentlemen, I have to applaud This is what makes America great. This is everything that makes America great. We can completely, unironically, have McDonald's sponsor the Olympics, not this year, not next Olympics, but for the Olympics for all the foreseeable future. That's right. The greatest athletes in the world are getting together for 2 weeks to do the world's largest commercial for a fast food restaurant. I love the beauty of it. I love the hypocrisy of it. I love the fact that McDonald's is probably not even the most unhealthy thing that sponsors the Olympics. I think Subway's on there. I think Dunkin' Donuts is on there. I see candy bar commercials all the time. When people look around and they wonder what makes America great, this is what makes America great. The fact that we're fat, we're getting fatter by the day, and we pump McDonald's while we're cheering on our best athletes. It's hypocrisy and fast food on the greatest level. John in North Carolina, give me your height, give me your weight.
Yeah, I'm 6'1", about 295.
Beautiful.
Yeah, I was just calling to tell you, you know, I thought Geek Time was bad, but man, your show really sucks, you fat fucking bastard guy.
Aw, that's so sad. Well, at least it was a fat guy. If I'm going to get yelled at by somebody, I mean, I hope he wasn't lying about his weight. Speaking of, I weighed in today at a whopping 264. When I started the show, I was at 287, so that's down 23 pounds. Like every fat guy, I have my issues with weight, both down and up. Right now, I'm on a downward trend, and I'll keep riding that as long as I can. But, and I'm 5'10". For whatever that makes the difference. Let's see if we can get a real caller up. CWB in Tennessee, I know you won't let me down. Give me your height, give me your weight.
Height 5'10", and as of now, since coming off the road in March, my weight went down from 560 to 500.
500 pounds, CWB!
Yo.
Fat guy, shout out to you, sir. So you drive a truck?
I used to. I come off the road in March.
Okay. And what do you want to say?
All right. I want to tell you a story about having to go without air conditioning on the road.
About
2 years ago.
Were you a big guy then? Were you still 500 pounds?
Oh, yeah, dude. I've been big my whole life. You know, mm-hmm. I've always been a fat kid.
Tell me about it.
But I was having to drive in Mississippi around this time of year,
mm-hmm.
like down there close to the fucking equator.
Okay.
And just, you talk about swamp ass.
What did you do? Now, you at least had the benefit of being in a moving vehicle. You had the windows open, but nothing beats the sweet, cool feel of the air conditioner against your skin. Am I right?
It is great, man. It is great. But that poor truck I was in, though, it was a black truck, too.
Oh.
So it was like riding in an oven.
It was smelly. It was an oven. I'm sure it was like one of the most uncomfortable things you could have gone through. Well, that's a great segue into the air conditioner. When you just hear that sound, like I said before, you just can't help but getting a chill through you. You can't help feeling that everything's going to be okay. You just came in from the disgusting outside humidity of the outside real world. And you walk into a department store or a movie theater or preferably your own apartment. Even here at the radio station, it's like 0 degrees, and that's not a complaint. We have excellent air conditioning here, and I love it. It is my ode to the air conditioner, and I want to take you, the audience, my fat guys, through a little history of the most important invention in the history of the world. The air conditioner started where all great things start, in Rome. Okay? This is the real cradle of civilization. What the Romans did was, they used to run cold water through their walls. I'm sure just the rich ones, by the way. Used to run cold water through their walls to keep their house cool. You could always count on those Romans looking for comfort. One of the emperors, this guy named, I'm going to mangle his name, Elagabalus, he imported snow from the mountains, and he built a giant mountain of snow right next to his house or castle, whatever the hell Roman people lived in. So that's going back, I don't know, Rob, what's that, 4,000, 5,000 years? Throw up a number. Rob says 10,000 years. Okay, 10,000 years that goes back. The air conditioner and that sort of concept was around for a little while until the Dark Ages came. And then the Catholic Church took away everything that was fun, and we lost any semblance of an air conditioner. But then, like almost every good thing we have today, especially for a fat guy, the Americans brought back the air conditioner in a big way. The first modern-day air conditioner was actually made for our president by our Navy, President James Garfield. He was shot, he was dying, and the room he was dying in, which is humid and gross and sticks, so the Navy made this machine or contraption that had fans fan big giant blocks of ice to keep the room cool, actually lowered the temperature in the room by 20 degrees. So that's not bad. That's not bad at all. But let's get to 1902, and let's honor a great man tonight on the Fat Guy Show. This one man's name, Willis Carrier of the Carrier Corporation. You probably know it is on almost every air conditioner you see nowadays. He was just looking for a way to control humidity in the paper plant he worked in. He wasn't trying to cool the world. He wasn't trying to change anything. He was just trying to make paper less humid. And he succeeded, and a byproduct of his dehumidifying machine was that it cooled the air. By 1925, he was introducing the first commercial air conditioners to the public. Do you understand that? Before 1925, there was no air conditioner. And this one guy, Willis Carrier, he changed the world. Let me explain to you how he changed the world. I feel like Rush Limbaugh. Let me explain to you how he changed the world. Before the AC, most businesses slowed or stopped in the summertime here in America. The government shut down in the summer. If it wasn't for AC, we might not be living in certain places in this country. Nobody was building houses in New Mexico or Arizona. Okay, the entire South just shut down over the summer. Why they couldn't compete economically. Air conditioners changed all that. It changed us into a 24/7, 365-day-a-year society. Okay? The very foundation of the great Industrial Revolution. That's the thing, right? That the Industrial Revolution is founded on the air conditioner. Without the air conditioner, we wouldn't have computer chips. Because you can't make computer chips in a hot room. We wouldn't have data storage centers. I don't know who that's important to, but it sounds like it's important to me. We wouldn't be able to, and this is something that's important to me and all fat guys, we would not be able to store and deliver food without the air conditioner. I would be stuck with whatever crap I could grow locally that you could get within a day. I guess it's what everyone's trying to get now, but we wouldn't have most of our chemical and pharmaceutical innovations without the air conditioner, because they're all done in cold storage rooms. The AC helped the West and the South become economic powerhouses, as they were able to finally open up year-round factories. Listen, I don't have to say much more. I want to hear from you guys. 888-STERN-101. That's 888-783-7610. Willis Carrier, we speak your name here on the Fat Guy Show. We speak your name. And here's a little clip from Community, great NBC show, on the greatness of the air conditioner.
You are here tonight because you have been selected as potential candidates for the Greendale Air Conditioning Repair School.
Feel that?
Actually, I don't feel...
Precisely. Have you heard the expression room temperature?
Of course.
This is the room.
No.
This is the room temperature room.
I can't tell where the air ends and my skin begins. It's incredible.
That's what we do, Troy. Incredible, invisible, unbelievable things. We're an unseen, unknown, invincible fraternity of craftsmen. Graduates of this school are guaranteed lucrative employment for their entire lives. And I'm inviting you to join us. There is one catch, Troy. Once you're in, you're in. Air conditioning repair will be your life. You will be an air conditioning repairman and nothing else until the day you die.
That was the great John Goodman on The Great Community, talking to the great Troy, played by the great, I can't remember his name, but he's good. Anyway, air conditioning is really important. It's everywhere. If you're an air conditioner repair person, I'd love to hear from you. But first, let's go to Dan in North Carolina. Dan, give me your height. Give me your weight.
What do you say, Jason? 6'7", 240.
Nice. That's pretty big. You're tall,
how about air conditioning? How about air conditioning pop culture references? Mosquito Coast, Harrison Ford brings air conditioning to the jungle. Ice is civilization.
That is 100% right. For anyone who doesn't know this movie, Harrison Ford plays this wacky scientist that drags his family into the middle of Africa or Asia or somewhere where it's 1,000 degrees. But he did. One of the things he brought right away, because everybody is sweating through that entire movie, right?
Except Harrison Ford in River Phoenix.
That's right. The white man brings the air conditioner.
What about Brady Bunch, where the kids get locked in Sam's meat locker, almost freeze to death?
I don't remember that. That is before my time, but I believe, was that a good episode?
That's fantastic.
You got one more for me?
No, that's
awesome. I wasn't expecting a two, and then when you went to, all right, fine. Jason in Boston, what's your height, what's your weight, and then tell me what happened this weekend.
What's up, Jason? How you doing?
What's up?
I am 6'2", 230, so I might be on the little, light on the fat scale, but believe me, I have all the fat characteristics.
We'll take you.
First of all, I got to give everyone a hint out there, a tip that you were talking about the t-shirt situation wearing too. What I've been doing recently is I found that Under Armour, it's like a cooling, thin material, feels real good against your skin.
Mm-hmm.
And then I go, that's my underlayer, and then the outer layer is a more formal, like, collared shirt like that, but it's that stretchy, cool polyester-type material. So it's like two layers of cooling T-shirts, and the first one absorbs all the sweat, and the second one, you can't even tell.
I'm going to have to look into the Under Armour. I'm actually wearing that exact material you described for the shirt, the stretchy, poly, light.
Yeah.
That's a fat guy, yeah.
Every shirt I wear is now that material, even in the winter. It's just, yeah. You got to stay cool.
You got to breathe, man.
Yeah, you gotta read, but this past weekend with the humidity was off the chain, and I was up in Maine visiting some dear friends, but they are like really healthy, environmentally conscious and everything. No AC, and they insisted on doing everything outdoors, so I literally was just dripping in sweat the entire weekend. It is just brutal.
Now, I know I joke that I wouldn't be able to survive that weekend, but I also fear for real that I wouldn't be able to survive that weekend. I just dropped out of a heart attack. What did you do?
What I did was they all went to bed early because they got kids and I got no kids. And then I went and turned the AC up, and every morning it was an ice box and they yelled at me, but I just dealt with it. And then when we were outside playing sports and stuff, I would sneak out to my car and I would cool down just having that AC blast on me.
Yep.
And I kept doing that in waves. You got to sneak out to your car.
You got to sneak out to your car. And you know what? You need the air conditioner. You need the air conditioner so much that, I'll tweet the story out a little later. Our Mayor Bloomberg, who is a very, health conscious guy at the very least, I don't know if anyone in the New York area saw this, but he had a full air conditioner, a full wall air conditioner attached to the side of his SUV. So his car didn't get hot when it was just waiting for him. He didn't want to leave the car running because that would waste the gas. So instead he decided to waste, I don't know how much electricity, dragging this gigantic air conditioner to his car. Air conditioner is not just for fat people. It's for everybody. Everybody needs it. And I'm sorry that you got stuck with such horrible, horrible friends. You should never visit them ever. Joe in Las Vegas, give me your height. Give me your weight.
I am about 5'8" and pretty close to... $3 bills.
Nice.
Quite a junker. But anyway, yeah, I live in Las Vegas, and, I haven't had air conditioning in about 3 years.
Are you kidding? You're over 300 pounds, and you don't have AC in Vegas?
Nah.
How is that possible? How are you living? What are you doing?
Well, I have a fan, but that's about it. The heat out here. See, there's no humidity, so you don't really sweat.
Don't give me that. Don't give me that no humidity. Is there any... Hold on. You're 300 pounds now, but did you originally start at 600 pounds?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, I started
I was just
at
checking.
About... okay. No, I probably started...
So you're here to say that you can live without AC?
It's not the best thing in the world, but yeah, I can live without it.
Now, if you don't have AC, Joe sounds like he doesn't have it by choice. Where are some of the places that you like to go to get cooled down? For me, it's the movie theater. Movie theater is the best place. It's actually one of the first places in America that carried an industrial air conditioner, and they usually are blasting. Department stores always have a ton of AC, but really movie theaters are the way to go. Hey, let's take a couple more calls, and then coming up after the break, we will be talking to the man who the New York Magazine said reinvented the burger, Pat LaFrieda. But let's talk a little bit more AC. I just love AC so much. I know it's important to everybody out there. Jim in Tennessee, what's your height? What's your weight?
6'2", 250 pounds.
Nicely done, sir. Tell me about your AC.
I drive a truck for a living, and in our trucks we got tri-packs. It's a little generator attached there, so it saves fuel, and you can turn this thing down to 50 degrees. And it gets so cold it will hurt your feet if you put it near it, And one time I forgot my cooler, ice for my cooler, and I put my lunch meat in front of it, and it kept it cold all night until I could get to the store to get
ice. And you keep it cold all the time, right?
Yeah,
that's beautiful.
It's for when you park.
Yeah, exactly. And what do you do if anyone was ever to come into your truck and try and turn down the air conditioner? What would happen?
I'd break their fingers.
That is right. That is a fat guy answer. Do not touch another man's air conditioner. Look, we're going to go to break.
We're going to talk AC all night. Call in with your AC story. It's 888-STERN-101. Coming up after the break, we're going to talk to Pat LaFrieda from the Food Network. He runs, I don't even know, he just runs meat. I think he's the king of meat. I don't understand how this works. I do a little bit. We'll explain it to you when we get back on the Fat Guy Show, only on Howard 101.
Well, don't you know that other kids are starving in Japan? So eat it. Just eat it.
Back to the Fat Guy Show. It tastes like chicken. The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan
on Howard 101.
Call 888-STERN-101.
Now, here's Jason Kaplan.
Welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. This is my ode to the air conditioner. That is a giant air conditioner you're listening to right now. Turn the radio up. Bend your head back and just enjoy it. Enjoy it. You ever do that when you walk in and you're just sweating and gross? Fat guys just sweat. You don't have to do anything. It doesn't even have to be hot out. You just have to be fat and you just start sweating and the sweat's coming off your forehead and into your eyes. And then you walk in the front door and that air conditioner is just, you feel the cold like when you touch the doorknob and you're like, oh, thank God they remembered to turn the air conditioner on. And you walk inside and the AC's blasting and you just walk right up to it and you stick your head right by the grates. I move my head. I'm like my cat. I just move like my head all over the grate. I make sure to get every angle under the chin, under the second and third chin, under all the chins. I love the air conditioner. Call in 888-STERN-101 to talk about your love of the air conditioner. But before we get to even more air conditioning talk, I have a guest on the phone. Let's give him a little fat intro, please.
Now it's time for a fat guest.
Now, my guest himself, per se, is not a fat man, but he is a supplier to the fat man. It is Meat Man, Pat LaFrieda. Pat, thanks for calling into the Fat Guy Show.
Oh, it's awesome to be on, Jason.
I'm really...
I'm on a fat man roller coaster, so I wouldn't say I'm on a fat man.
Well, you have a good publicist, because all the pictures of you online, you look very svelte. I need to get one of those.
I pick and choose those, but I'm so mesmerized by the air conditioning reference. I love that.
Oh, that's great. Hey, so Pat, for anyone who doesn't know Pat, he is are you the owner-operator now of Pat LaFrieda Meats?
I'm the third generation, but my dad still works with me, but I am now the owner and operator of our family business, which is a wholesale meat distributorship. So we supply restaurants and hotels with meat.
Right. And you know, maybe that doesn't sound too impressive until you start looking into it and you realize that not only has your business been around for 90 years, all owned by your family, but you supply meat, not just to restaurants and hotels, but the restaurants, the hotels, the burger places. You are known for the high and high quality beef and you're known for knowing your meat better than anybody.
I am, and that didn't happen overnight. I did have two generations to build from, but mm-hmm. we are lucky enough to work with America's best chefs and restaurants. And, I mean, the heart of the best food in the country is right here in New York. So it's easy for that to happen, but restaurants like Shake Shack and Mario Batali's restaurants, Danny Meyer's, Joe Bastianich's, we supply them all.
If anyone has ever been to New York in the last 5 years, you will know there's been an explosion of boutique burger restaurants from Shake Shack was absolutely the original and furthest back. But now you have Five Napkin Burger, Five Borough Burger, Better Burger, Pop Burger, burger places all over the place. And Pat, this is really a lot of it's because of you. You took the burger to the next level.
I did. Historically, only trimmings were used in making chopped beef or ground beef and made into burgers. So if you only use the leftovers, which was a lot of sinew, connective tissue, and what was ever left over, you could never control the flavor profile of what you were putting into the burger. Like my grandfather always told me that you cannot hide your sins in a chopped beef machine. And that's what a lot of companies always did. So my grandfather had a pretty straightforward recipe of using whole cuts of beef as opposed to those trimmings. And we were always a little bit more money. It cost more money to do that.
Mm-hmm. I buy your meat. Then, I know.
And when the hamburger revolution came, we were right there. So we already had a great foundation to build from. And then I tweaked my grandfather's blend using different muscle groups and whether it be sirloin or round, or whether it be grass fed or corn fed or organic. Like, we have taken every blend that you could possibly make and put them into different restaurants, so that in New York City, every restaurant can be different from each other, yet still buy meat from me. Whereas historically, different meat companies would have their chop beef and that was it. I went a step further and was able to tweak these blends for specific restaurants so that they did have their own personal niche, and they were different from the restaurant next door.
Now, to explain to the audience, what Pat's really describing sounds to me like is like what happens in wine, where you have all these great cuts of meat and short rib and beef and tenderloin, and somebody like a Danny Meyer from Shake Shack comes to you and says, hey, let's take this meat and combine it in a way and use different parts of the cow that people haven't used before for burgers to make something that's not only delicious but unique to my restaurant.
Exactly. And with Danny, when Shake Shack first opened in the park, we just had a little flat top to work with.
Mm-hmm.
So we had to make something that wasn't too fatty, because on a flat top, the beef is cooking in its own fat, and something that was very different from anything else. And my favorite cut of meat, which was my grandfather's also, for making chopped beef, is brisket. There's nothing beats the buttery flavor of the fat in brisket, but briskets were only ever used for corned beef, sometimes pastrami. Like, to use that, to grind that, is something just people never did.
Right, it's crazy. It's crazy.
To take that and mix it with flat irons and Shake Shack, it took us, you know, at least 20 tastings to get to what would be perfect for that application of smashing that burger down onto that flat top at 700 degrees and to get the caramelization and then to flip it over and to get the same on the other side.
So talk slower, Pat. Talk slower. Say that again.
No, it took
caramelization.
A lot of
yes,
planning.
Yeah. That sounds great. So obviously, you know, your business and your and your cousin and your father, you know, you took this concept of really respecting the hamburger, as I see it. It's not going to be the hot dog. We're not going to take the leftover crap and serve it to you on the bun. We're going to take the really good meat and we're going to let you taste it. What are the trends besides that you see now working with places like, what else? Do you do Bill's Bar and Burger, and I know you do, Spotted Pig.
Oh, yes.
What is
yes.
the trend? What are people looking for when the chefs come to you? What are they looking for out of their burgers?
Well, when a chef comes to me with a burger concept or an idea, I first ask them to tell me what steaks they like to eat.
Mm-hmm.
And then I can match that flavor profile with a blend of meat that's also affordable. I mean, there's only so much you could charge for hamburgers.
Right.
Minetta Tavern's Black Label Burger, which I created, is a combination of aged beef, which is very expensive. But very few restaurants can charge in the high $20 range for a hamburger. So we have to translate the flavor profile that our chef is looking for into what is affordable.
Right. Okay. So, yeah. So, do you want... Now, I know one of the things about my... Here's what I love about a burger, and I have to ask you about your Fresh Direct mixes, because I'm a Fresh Direct customer, and I was excited it's a great company, and it's very convenient. Fat guy friendly. You don't have to leave the house. They come right to your door. You can save your shopping list online. This is they're not a sponsor. This is just happening. Pat sells his meats on Fresh Direct, but Fat Guys, I haven't gone inside a supermarket in forever. It's beautiful. And you have all sorts of meat up there. You have, I just wrote them down real quick, because you have you sell your, actually, what do you call it? Is it chopped or ground? And what's the difference? Your meat.
We make chopped beef.
Okay.
And it's a little coarser than ground beef. What we're looking to do is keep that coarseness so we could keep the integrity of these cuts so we could actually taste it. Whereas ground beef is really almost emulsified. And it's something great for central booking or, the public school system.
Right. And let's be very, very clear about this, because we got scared in the beginning of the summer, end of the spring, with this pink slime nonsense. There is no pink slime in your meat. Is that correct, sir?
Never. No.
Never.
I'll tell you, pink slime is something that we're so far removed from that I had to explain to my father what it was when it came out in the news. He didn't even understand the concept. But no, that's the pink slime is a product of trimmings. So they just took trimmings and which were 50% fat, 50% meat, and kind of made it into that homogenous look just to get an inexpensive burger. That's exactly what we are against.
Right.
Although it wasn't as dangerous as the media portrayed it, but when people got to see what it really was, they weren't happy to have to eat that.
I think it was just more gross than, you know.
Exactly.
Than dangerous. Like, listen, I'm sure they say in your business, no one wants to know how the cow is killed. Just give me the meat. I don't want to see. I don't care. You know, I was fine with the pink slime until I realized it was there. Speaking of, you grew up in a family of butchers. Did you ever have to kill a cow, know a cow? Did they take you through the entire process of that, or is that something you're removed from?
No, kill a cow, no. We don't slaughter any animals in our business. But when I was young, what my dad did was he took me to a veal slaughterhouse, and these calves were coming off the we now like to say harvest line, but the slaughter line,
mm-hmm.
and it was still warm inside. And my dad, in trying to instill to me to study and not get into this business, maybe put my hands inside the animal while it was still warm. And it didn't bother me. And it kind of worked in reverse. Here I am in the company business. I mean, I was the generation that was supposed to go off to school and learn something else and have an easier path in life and not work in 35 degree temperature all night. But this is the only thing that I ever loved to do.
That's awesome.
Studied finance, but what's better than serving meat to restaurants that they're going to cook great dishes out of?
I have an answer for you. It's called eating the meat at that great restaurant. But you have the second best job. If you have a question or just something you want to talk to Pat about, please call 888-STERN-101. That's 888-783-7610. And let's talk about that temperature you worked in. You spend most of your working career in 36 degree temperatures. Is that correct?
Yes, 35, 36, unless you go into the freezer, which is minus 10.
I said, so it is safe to say that without refrigeration and the air conditioner, your family wouldn't have a business.
It's very true. I like when visitors come in the summer and they're like, this is great in here. I'm like, okay, come back in the winter.
Well, I'm sure it gets
old. Inside to warm up.
I'm sure it's old for you, but in reality, you know, even back in the 1920s when your great-grandfather opened the shop?
My grandfather and his older brother.
Grandfather and his older brother. I mean, I don't know what the refrigeration was like back then, but I would imagine that you're now able to bring meat to places you were never able to bring meat to before.
It's true. I mean, with technology now, we ship to Las Vegas twice a week. We're out to Chicago twice a week, down to Miami twice a week. So, I mean, besides the five boroughs and the tri-state area, we're really able to get our product pretty much all over the country. I mean, hitting the West Coast is a little bit of a reach, especially when you try to supply restaurants every day with fresh product, but Vegas is simple.
Vegas is simple. All right, I have a ton of meat. So when I make a hamburger, Pat, and I apologize if I'm boring the audience, but I love making my own burgers. I love grilling. And so what I usually do is I get 80 to 85% ground chuck or beef, and I usually mix a little butter in with it. And some other little spices, secret recipe. I'll share it with you off air, Pat. Because I like my meat. When I like a hamburger, I don't want it to taste like a meatloaf. I don't even necessarily want it to taste like a steak. I want it to taste like a burger, and I want it to melt in my mouth. So I see you have on Fresh Direct beef, chuck, round, sirloin, rib beef blend, and a premium ground beef blend. You don't need to take me through all of these, but what are the differences between some of these meats? And as a consumer, what am I looking for?
Fresh Direct has a clientele that really enjoys very lean beef, the 90% lean.
I hate that.
I really don't like that very much at all.
My man.
I'm even more into the 75-25 range.
You could get that?
Because not in Fresh Direct, but...
Okay, hold on a second, Pat.
Actually, you can. With the La Frida original burgers that Fresh Direct carries, yes, you can.
Oh, those are the pre-made patties on there, right?
Yes, those are the patties that are made. But those are made in an exclusive machine that's textured fill. So instead of just filling the shape of a hamburger and the machine moving, like this fills in the noodle form so that when you eat that hamburger, it's as close to a handmade burger as possible. And you just hit the nail on the head when you said you didn't want your burger to taste like meatloaf.
Yeah.
When you start to add too much stuff to the chopped beef and you start to mix it, that's when you'll get it to taste like meatloaf.
That's 100% correct.
Softening the outside, great. And then another little trick, fresh pepper after it's cooked. A great chef taught me that cooking with pepper on the meat can sometimes turn the pepper a little bitter. So Mike LaMonaco of Porter House, New York, taught me that trick, and I can't tell you how much it's changed the game for me when it comes to cooking burgers.
And steaks, too, or do you put the pepper on when you cook the steaks as well?
Well, steaks also. That's what he was talking about.
Right, okay,
I brought
cool.
it to burgers.
I love it.
Yeah, a nice salt crust from the sear. Because I like my people always assume that I like it, like, really rare. I don't. I like my medium rare. Yep. I want the outside seared, yep. And I still want red in the center. Because that's my way of tasting the product. That's my way of tasting it. Any other way, you might as well, if you cook it well done, you're losing all the goodness in it.
Pat,
you really
Pat, are. You're on the Fat Guy Show and you're a meat guy. We're not even going to entertain well done. You could just skip ahead. this is, please,
very good.
Don't insult the audience. We're fine. If anyone eats their meat well done, feel free to change the channels now. Okay, go on.
Unless you're cooking for children, right? I mean.
Yeah, whatever. yeah, children, sure. Okay. Pat?
Yeah.
Was you? Oh, I thought you,
No,
let's go eat some raw meat. Okay, so you like, yeah, I like it too. I like it. I like it medium rare, maybe a little on the rare side, but I like a little crunch on the outside, a little sear, like you said. You know, reminds you you're eating meat. What I hate more than anything, what makes me cringe, and it sounds like it makes you cringe. You go over someone's house and they're gonna make some burgers, and you see them put like eggs and bread crumbs in the burger. That freaks me out. Like, I want to get up and leave.
Do that.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, you might as well put tomato sauce and make it meatloaf or something. No,
I
do not like that at all. You completely lose what a hamburger is.
Exactly. And to that point, and this is something I argue with my friend John Hine about, when you have a burger or a steak, well, really a burger, because I don't really put anything on the steak, but when you have a burger, do you see putting a condiment on, like ketchup, mustard, or mayonnaise, is that a sin to you? Does that cover up the meat, or...
No, it doesn't. It doesn't. I'm very liberal when it comes to that. Whatever anyone loves. But personally, I'm a big mayonnaise fanatic.
Oh.
So
you're my new best friend, officially.
I go for a dollar of mayonnaise, and my tomatoes have to be perfect. If those real huge tomatoes that when you cut them, they taste like watermelon, I don't like.
Yep.
I like little grape tomatoes. I cut them up, and I put them on. They're real crisp and burst with flavor, but... Everything can go wrong on the outside. If the bread is off,
oh,
it can mess up everything.
That's right. You know what? I have 500 more questions for you. Would you mind hanging on through the break, and we'll just come
I'm
back?
I'm all yours, buddy.
All right. Awesome. Thanks so much. We're talking to Pat LaFrieda. Pat is debuting the Pat LaFrieda Original Filet Mignon Sandwich at Citi Field tomorrow. We'll talk about that when we come back from the break. And you're learning how to make burgers here, people. You're learning how to be fat. This is a fat world. Call in 888-STERN-101. We'll be right back with the Fat Guy Show.
Yes, go have that snack. We'll be right back.
There's more to come. Call 888-STERN-101.
The Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan.
On Howard 101.
Back to the fat. It's the Fat Guy Show.
Watch out, fat boy.
Oh my God, he's huge.
He makes sumo wrestlers look healthy.
We're back with the Fat Guy Show with Jason Kaplan on Howard 101.
Call 888-STERN-101. Now, here's Jason Kaplan.
Welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. Ode to the air conditioner. Call in 888-STERN-101. And producer Jim McClure just gave me a great fat guy tip for New York City specifically. If it's 90 with 100% humidity and the cab comes to pick you up and the windows are down, don't get in. That means the air conditioner is not working, and it probably reeks in there. So that's just a fat guy tip. Also, Chris Carlin, who was on the last Fat Guy Show from the SNY Network, gave a great tip about fat guys take cold showers or cool showers. Don't take hot showers. The hot showers make you sweat. Welcome back to the Fat Guy Show. Joining me is Pat LaFrieda. Pat, you are debuting your original filet mignon steak sandwich at Citi Field tomorrow. I saw pictures of this. It's gorgeous. Tell me what goes into this.
We're so excited. We actually found a way, because have you ever had a steak sandwich where the steak is so tough when you pull the bread away from your mouth, the steak slaps you in the chin?
Yeah, the whole piece comes out with you.
Right.
Yeah.
So what we've always done was we've used filet mignon medallions for that for steak sandwich. So when you eat it, it's so tender, it just melts in your mouth. But filet, you could get great flavor to filet mignon by caramelizing it, like we talked about earlier with the burger. So filet, you have to eat rare.
Yes.
At the worst case scenario, medium rare. So we actually are going to serve a filet mignon medallion, three of those, caramelized with Monterey Jack cheese and sweet Vidalia onions over the top, with a little au jus sauce on the inside of a custom locally baked French baguette. And it is so delicious.
Oh, my God. Now, are you going to be able, first of all, there's no blood left in my head. Hold on a second. Second of all, it all went to my stomach. Second of all, this sounds beautiful. Go look up online. Just look for the Pat LaFrieda original filet mignon steak at Citi Field. If you're going to a Mets game tomorrow, it will be available for the first time ever. And please call in at the next Fat Guy Show. Give us reports. But where are you going to be able to buy it throughout the stadium? Is it only going to be one area, or is it going to be available throughout the stadium?
It's in that one area, which is the main part of the Taste of New York. So if you've seen what Citi Field has done to food, it's just amazing. They've brought great quality food to a ballpark.
Yeah, they brought you, because you do Shake Shack too, right?
Shake Shack, I supply the meat to Blue Smoke. If anyone likes fish, they have catch of the day there, so you get fresh sushi caught every day by Dave Pasternak. Like, there's some great food at Citi Field.
It is literally, and Pat, I'm going to not go out on a limb here, because this is you are the best thing in Met Stadium right now. I mean, you're the only thing winning, and you're really, when people turn up tomorrow, it's not going to be able to see David Wright. It's going to be to go get the Pat LaFrieda filet mignon. That's why I'm going. You know, I wish the Mets were as good as your meat.
I always, you know, being a New Yorker, we always hope that they'll pull it out by the end, but at least in this case, we have some really good food to eat while we're watching the game. But it's really an honor to work with the Mets and to be able to actually serve something that dates back as far as my grandfather, and like to bring that to the field. Because when we were talking to the owners not long ago, and we were going through the entire food program, because we sell meat to their high-end restaurants there also, aged bone-in strip steaks and porterhouse steaks. We were looking around, and they said, you know, the one thing we don't have here is a steak sandwich. So I said, I have an idea for you. And he, you know, a couple of days later, he had me in, and I cooked one for him, and he said, all right, we open in 2 weeks. I was like, what? Yeah, we're going to open the Pat LaFrieda steak sandwich just the way you made it, just like that. And I was, you know, because no ballparks work that quickly. There's so much politics involved and red tape. And those guys are just, they're really food-driven. Yeah. They really want that experience of having a great meal at a ballpark, and I couldn't be more honored to do it.
That's awesome. Well, they have a lot of free time not thinking about baseball to come up with good food options. But I have to say, as a as a Yankee fan, as much as I love the Yankees and love Yankee Stadium, the food there is really subpar for that big, beautiful stadium. They have Johnny Rockets, which is fine normally, but it's not good in the stadium. And they have that Lobel's, and I don't know what your relationship is with them, so I apologize, but it's not
worth the
wait online for the sandwich to get their Lobel's sandwich there. It's just not.
That's what I hear. But let me tell you, the gem in Yankee Stadium is to go to NYY Steakhouse.
Oh, okay, I haven't been there yet.
So New York Yankee Steakhouse, you need tickets? And then you need to make a reservation, and they have the most high-end meat up in that area.
All right. Well, I didn't make it up to the steakhouse yet. I'll have to do that.
It's a little hidden gem, yeah.
Okay. Hey, so, okay, we're running out of time, and I'm dying to ask you about this. There are Fat Guy innovations, and then there are Fat Guy innovations. And I read in the paper a few months ago that they have somehow, some way, after 10,000 years of the cow existing, found a new steak in the cow. They're calling it the Las Vegas Strip. It's from a group of guys that call themselves the Meat Geeks. What is going on here? Is this a real thing, or am I being pandered to?
Well, first of all, I don't think it's fat guy friendly at all. It doesn't have much intramuscular fat. It's not going to be your juicy steak. What they did was, because of the economy, they tried to find some good economy cuts in the animal and find some things that guys like me would normally put into the chop beef. So they pull all of these great cuts out, and the rest they throw into the trimmings. And one of these cuts, somebody dubbed the Vegas strip steak, and I believe he's trying to get a trademark on it.
Yeah, he's trying to patent it. Which, can you do that? Can you patent pieces of meat?
I think he's got a rough ahead of him. But as soon as they sent it, I knew exactly where it was in the animal. I had some restaurants asking for it because of the press, and I have been supplying it. I'm not a fan of it. I don't think much of it. If you have ever had a flat iron steak, it's the muscle right next to it. It's almost identical to the flat iron. So it's a thin steak.
It's not for me. Oval, if it's thin. Yeah. It's
oval shaped. Yeah. It'd be more like a flank steak. Not my favorite.
Yeah.
I like to see intramuscular fat. I like for steaks to be real juicy. If I have to tenderize it somehow or marinate it, you lost me on that one.
I'm with you, and I also like to be able to cook it with a sear, which you can't, you can't do without ruining the meat unless it's an inch, inch and a half thick.
You're right. Yeah. Otherwise, it's overdone.
Right. All right, Pat, we're running out of time. I want to make sure we hit all your stuff here. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
That's okay.
Okay, so we have the original filet mignon sandwich that is going to be at Citi Field starting tomorrow and going on for as long as time goes, where you supply them with the sandwich. You are also going to be at Meatopia at Randall's Island in September. What is Meatopia?
September 8th, Meatopia is an amazing event. Everyone listening that loves meat needs to get to Meatopia, because we're going to have about 30 of America's best chefs cooking meat from all different types of meat from all parts of the United States, and it is just an amazing place to be. And we cook in a big cajachina box an 875-pound steer whole for 30 hours. And it just comes out, and it's juicy, and it just falls off the bone. And we don't serve it with any bread, no sides. We just pass it out so people could taste what good prime American beef tastes like.
Oh, that is awesome. I'm telling you, Pat, if somehow, some way I don't see you between now and September 8th, I will be seeing you out there, and we will be sharing a steak sandwich together.
I look forward to that.
We have to make it happen. Go to meatopia.org for more information on Meatopia. For more information on Pat, you could go to patlafrida.com or follow him on Twitter at patlafrida. That's PATLAFRIEDA. And of course, check out his steak sandwich at Citi Field. Pat, thank you so much for calling in on this very special fat guy ode to the air conditioner and barbecue on Howard 101. 101.
It's an honor to be on with you. Thank you, Jason.
Thank you very much, Pat. Have a great night. We're wrapping it up here on the Fat Guy Show. But before we go, my board op, the great Alfred Ragone, who helps with all the great sounds and everything you hear during the show, came to me last week and he said, you are talking about the Dunkin' Donuts Oreo Culotta. And I said, no, tell me about this. I love the Oreo and I don't know anything about it. Al, I have one. Do you have one over there?
Oh, I got one.
Do you know which one I have? I think it's the vanilla one.
Yeah, there's two of them. There's coffee and vanilla bean. We gave you one of each.
Oh, you gave me. Where's the other one?
Right there.
Jim's hoarding it. All right, hold on a second. I'm going to try the vanilla one right here. Now, Al, why sip? Will you explain what's going on here?
It's the new Dunkin' Donuts Colada. It's available in coffee or vanilla bean flavors. It's basically a colada mixed with chopped up Oreo, like cookies and cream. It's offered with or without whipped cream. It was introduced with the Oreo donut and the Oreo crumb donut, which are 300 to 400 calories each. And the bad news, unfortunately, is that it's a limited time Dunkin' Donuts treat. It won't be here forever, so you have to enjoy it now.
Hold on, I'm doing an experiment back here.
Mm-hmm.
What I did was the vanilla one's a little too sweet for me.
Okay.
And the coffee one's not sweet enough.
Right.
So I've now poured half the vanilla culotta into the coffee culotta. Jim's looking for napkins.
There you go.
I just ruined the entire studio, I think. But hold on a second.
Well, just while we're waiting, the vanilla bean one, the small. starts at 420 calories and goes up to the large, which is 850 calories.
Oh, that's funny.
And a large coffee flavored is anywhere from 580 to 970 calories.
Well, I have to say, Al, this is a great tip to stay cool in the summer. It's delicious. I love Oreos, and basically they've taken a milkshake. I mean, I don't know. It's definitely not as thick as a milkshake. It's coffee, I guess, right? Mm-hmm. Sure. Sure, Dunkin' Donuts is coffee. It's delicious, and it's a great way to stay cool. Of course, we talked about avoiding those cabs with open windows in the summertime. Take cool showers and crank up your AC, and every day say his name, Willis Carrier, the American inventor of the air conditioner as we know it. I'd like to thank everybody for joining me tonight, especially my friend Pat LaFrieda, who eats meat right. He doesn't just sell meat, but he eats it right with mayonnaise, and he eats it pretty rare. Pat LaFrieda Original Filet Mignon Sandwich debuts at City Field tomorrow. And, of course, you can check him out at Meatopia and at patlafrieda.com. And I don't know when we'll be back with the next Fat Guy show, but it'll certainly be cooler out. Thanks for joining me on Howard 101.